The business trip to Austin was supposed to be a routine stopover in my busy life. I had booked a chic downtown apartment through Airbnb, seeking a little comfort amid the whirlwind of meetings and networking events. When I arrived, the August heat hit me like a wave, but the apartment was a cool oasis, stylishly decorated and offering a perfect view of the city's skyline. My host, Olivia, greeted me warmly. She was in her early 40s, with a charm that put me at ease. She gave a brief tour, her voice soft and friendly, asking about my plans in Austin. I mentioned the conference, and she nodded approvingly, offering restaurant recommendations and tips on navigating the city. That first night, exhausted from travel and a long day of meetings, I returned to the apartment. I double-checked the locks before settling into bed, eager for a good night's sleep. The faint noises from outside didn't bother me. I attributed them to the city's nightlife. Little did I know that night was the beginning of a nightmare. I woke up the next morning feeling disoriented. The sunlight streamed through the windows, casting a harsh light on the chaos around me. My laptop, wallet, and travel documents were gone. The sleek modern room felt suddenly foreign and hostile. Panic gripped me as I realized the apartment door was slightly ajar. I had locked it, hadn't I? Desperation clawed at me as I called Olivia. She answered on the first ring, her voice filled with concern. She sounded genuinely shocked and advised me to report the incident to the police immediately. Her reaction seemed sincere, but a nagging doubt had already started to form in my mind. Detective Ramirez from the Austin PD arrived shortly after. He was a seasoned officer, his eyes sharp and assessing. He found no signs of forced entry, which meant someone with a key had accessed the apartment. Olivia arrived as well, her expression a mask of worry and empathy. She cooperated fully with the investigation, but something about her demeanor seemed off to me. She was too composed, too prepared. As the hours passed, my frustration and fear grew. I decided to take matters into my own hands. I began researching similar incidents in the area, hoping to find a pattern. My search led me to online forums and news articles about other travelers who had been robbed in downtown Austin Airbnb rentals. The stories were eerily similar to mine, right down to the friendly host and the absence of forced entry. I contacted two previous victims, Jennifer and Marcus, who had stayed at different properties but described experiences that mirrored mine. Jennifer, a 28-year-old consultant, had lost her laptop and jewelry. Marcus, a 40-year-old IT specialist, had been stripped of his expensive gadgets and cash. Both had stayed at properties managed by different hosts, but the descriptions of those hosts bore an uncanny resemblance to Olivia. A chilling realization dawned on me. Olivia had managed other properties under different aliases, orchestrating a series of robberies to fund her lavish lifestyle. Determined to find proof, I visited the addresses of these properties, each one connected back to her, the pattern becoming disturbingly clear. Armed with this evidence, I confronted Olivia. I expected denial, but her face darkened with anger instead. "You shouldn't have dug into this," she hissed, her friendly facade crumbling. She was no longer the charming host, but a cornered predator. I had informed Detective Ramirez of my findings earlier, and he arrived just in time to detain Olivia. Her reaction was a mix of fury and resignation, as if she knew her game was finally up. During the interrogation, the true depth of her deceit was revealed. Olivia had copied keys and monitored guests' activities, striking when they were most vulnerable. The investigation led to a storage unit where Olivia had stashed stolen items, including my belongings. Seeing my things again brought a wave of relief, but the knowledge of how close I had come to a far worse fate left a lingering fear. With Olivia arrested and charged with multiple counts of theft and fraud, I felt a sense of justice. Detective Ramirez commended my determination and gave me advice on future travel safety. Yet the ordeal had changed me. I returned home, shaken but relieved, vowing to share my story to warn others about the dangers lurking behind a friendly smile. Back in my everyday life, the shadows of that weekend in Austin stayed with me. Nightmares plagued my sleep, and I couldn't shake the feeling of being watched. I became an advocate for safer travel practices, writing articles, and giving talks about my experience. Olivia's arrest led to a crackdown on similar scams, making travel safer for others. but I knew the deception that had almost ensnared me could never be entirely eradicated. Ethan's Law, they called it. New regulations for short-term rentals, inspired by my ordeal. The name felt strange, almost surreal, as if the horror had happened to someone else. But I remembered Olivia's cold eyes and the terror of waking up to find my world turned upside down. The incident stayed with me, a constant reminder that sometimes the most charming places and people hide the darkest secrets. The storm raged as I drove along the deserted highway, the windshield wipers struggling to keep up with the deluge. It had been a long day at the conference, and all I wanted was to reach my Airbnb cabin and crash for the night. My GPS indicated another 30 miles to go when I saw him, a lone figure, drenched and shivering, thumb extended in a desperate plea for a ride. I hesitated but then remembered the storm. Leaving someone out here could be dangerous. I slowed down and rolled down the passenger window. "Need a lift?" I shouted over the roar of the rain. The man, probably in his mid-30s, nodded gratefully. "Thanks. My car broke down a few miles back." He climbed in, shaking off the water like a dog. "I'm Mark," I said, trying to be polite. "Alex," he replied, offering a damp handshake. His grip was firm, his eyes dark and intense. We drove in silence for a while. I couldn't shake the feeling that there was something off about Alex, but I chalked it up to my own tiredness and the eerie atmosphere created by the storm. "So, where are you headed?" I asked to break the silence. "Just trying to get to the next town," he said. "I was visiting a friend, but my car had other plans." "Rough night for it," I said, glancing at him. He seemed normal enough, if a bit quiet. Still, I couldn't shake the feeling that he was studying me too intently. We finally arrived at the cabin, a cozy but isolated retreat nestled among the trees. The storm showed no signs of letting up, and I felt a pang of guilt at the thought of sending Alex back out into it. "You're welcome to stay here tonight," I offered. "There's a guest room." "Thanks, I really appreciate it," he said, his smile not quite reaching his eyes. Inside, I showed Alex to the guest room and then collapsed on the couch with a sigh. The storm pounded against the windows, and the howling wind made the cabin creak. I tried to focus on the TV, but my mind kept wandering back to Alex. I decided to call it a night and headed to my room. I locked the door behind me, feeling a bit silly for doing so, but unable to shake the sense of unease. I fell into a restless sleep, the storm outside a constant, unsettling presence. Sometime in the early hours, I awoke to a strange sound. It was subtle, like someone moving stealthily through the cabin. I strained to listen but heard nothing further. "Just my imagination," I told myself. The next morning I found Alex in the kitchen making coffee. "Morning," he said cheerfully. "I hope you don't mind. I figured I owed you at least a cup." "Not at all," I replied, though the sight of him in my kitchen was jarring. We drank our coffee in awkward silence, and I couldn't help but notice how Alex seemed to know his way around the kitchen too well for someone who had just arrived. "So, what do you do, Mark?" he asked suddenly. "Business consultant," I said. "You?" "Freelancer," he replied vaguely. As the day wore on, I noticed more oddities. Items in my cabin seemed to have been moved. My laptop, which I was sure I had left on the dining table, was now on the coffee table. My phone had been plugged into its charger, though I didn't remember doing that. I decided to confront Alex. "Did you move my stuff?" I asked, trying to keep my tone casual. Alex looked at me innocently. "No, why would I? Must have been the wind or something." "The wind? Inside the cabin?" His response made no sense, and the unease that had been simmering beneath the surface began to boil over. That night the power went out. The storm had knocked out the electricity, plunging the cabin into darkness. I found a flashlight and some candles, and Alex and I sat in the dim light, the atmosphere growing increasingly tense. "Tell me about your family, Mark," Alex said suddenly. The question was innocuous enough, but the way he asked it made my skin crawl. "Why do you want to know?" I replied, trying to keep my voice steady. "Just making conversation," he said with a smile that seemed more like a smirk. I didn't sleep that night. Every time I closed my eyes, I imagined Alex creeping through the cabin, watching me. The next morning, I resolved to get rid of him. The storm had finally passed, and it was time for him to go. "You should be able to get a tow truck now," I told him over breakfast. "I'll give you a ride to town." Alex didn't argue, which only heightened my suspicion. As we drove, he started talking again, this time about my dog, Charlie. "How do you know about my dog?" I demanded. "Social media," he said casually. "You post about him a lot." I hadn't mentioned Charlie to him, and my social media profiles were private. My heart pounded as I realized how much he knew about me. Too much. We reached the small town, and I dropped him off at a diner. "Thanks for the ride," he said, that unsettling smile back on his face. "Take care, Mark." I watched him walk away, a sense of relief washing over me, but the feeling didn't last. When I returned to the cabin, I found my laptop open to my email, with a draft message addressed to me. The subject line read, "You can't hide." Panic set in. I grabbed my phone to call the police, but it was dead, though I had charged it overnight. Alex had tampered with it. My mind raced as I tried to figure out what to do next. Then I heard the door creak open. Alex stood there, a sinister smile on his face. "Miss me?" Fear gripped me. I backed away, trying to think of a way out. Alex advanced slowly, enjoying my terror. "You can't escape, Mark," he said. "I know everything about you." Desperation fueled my next move. I grabbed a heavy lamp and swung it at him. He dodged, but I managed to hit his shoulder. He stumbled, and I took the chance to run. I fled into the woods, the remnants of the storm turning the ground to mud. Alex was right behind me, but I knew the area better. I led him in circles, trying to lose him in the dense trees. Eventually, I reached a road and flagged down a passing car. The driver, a kind older woman, let me use her phone to call the police. When they arrived, Alex was long gone, but they assured me they would find him. I returned to the cabin with the officers, who found evidence of Alex's obsession. Photos of me, printouts of my social media posts, even a detailed schedule of my daily routine. The police promised to keep me informed, but the damage was done. I couldn't stay at the cabin. I packed my things and left, vowing to be more careful about what I shared online. Even now, back in the city, I can't shake the feeling that I'm being watched. Alex might be gone, but his shadow lingers, a constant reminder of how fragile our sense of security can be. The mansion stood grandly against the twilight sky as we arrived, our weekend getaway filled with promises of luxury and relaxation. It was Emma who had found the place on Airbnb, a sprawling estate far removed from the bustle of the city. Mr. Gray, the host, greeted us with a warm smile and a firm handshake, his eyes crinkling at the corners in what I hoped was genuine friendliness. Inside, the mansion was even more impressive. Marble floors, chandeliers, and plush furniture gave it an almost surreal air of opulence. "This is amazing," Sarah whispered, her eyes wide with awe. We spent the first few hours exploring. Jake, ever the adventurer, was determined to see every inch of the place. It was in the basement that we found the locked door. "What's behind there?" Jake wondered aloud, his curiosity piqued. "Probably just storage," Tom shrugged. But Jake was already fiddling with a bobby pin trying to pick the lock. "Jake, don't!" Emma started, but the lock clicked open. The room beyond was a stark contrast to the rest of the mansion. Dimly lit, it was filled with shelves of old photographs, personal belongings, and various tools that made my stomach churn. "What is this?" Lisa breathed, horror evident in her voice. "Evidence," Emma said, her face pale. "Evidence of crimes." Panic set in quickly. "We need to leave," Sarah said, her voice trembling. We rushed upstairs, only to find that our phones had no signal and the landline was dead. "This can't be happening," I muttered, my mind racing. Mr. Gray appeared then, his friendly demeanor gone. "What are you doing in my basement?" he demanded, his voice cold. We found something," Jake stammered. We need to leave. You're not going anywhere, Mr. Gray said, his eyes now hard and dangerous. You've damaged my property and trespassed. We'll pay for any damages, Emma tried to negotiate, but Mr. Gray was unmoved. We ran to the car, but it wouldn't start. Jake popped the hood and swore. The engine's been tampered with, he said, his voice grim. He's going to kill us, Sarah whispered, her eyes filling with tears. We need to stick together, Emma said, her voice steady despite the fear in her eyes. We need to find a way to defend ourselves. We split up to search the mansion for anything that could be used as a weapon. I ended up in the kitchen, grabbing the largest knife I could find. Lisa found a heavy candlestick, and Tom came back with a golf club. We need a plan, Emma said. We can't just wait for him to come to us. We decided to set a trap in the basement. It was risky, but it was the only place we knew he would come to check. We hid, waiting in tense silence. Every creak of the house made my heart jump. Hours seemed to pass before we heard footsteps descending the stairs. Mr. Gray entered the basement, his flashlight cutting through the darkness. Come out, wherever you are, he taunted. At Emma's signal, we attacked. The struggle was brutal. Mr. Gray was strong and fought back with a ferocity that seemed inhuman, but our desperation gave us strength. Jake managed to knock the flashlight from his hand, plunging the room into near darkness. I swung the knife, cutting his arm, while Tom landed a solid blow to his head with the golf club. Mr. Gray fell to the floor unconscious. We need to tie him up, Emma said, her voice shaky but determined. Using some of the ropes we found in the basement, we bound his hands and feet. With Mr. Gray secured, we searched his pockets and found his keys. Emma grabbed them and ran upstairs, unlocking the front door. We stumbled out into the cold night air, running down the long driveway towards the nearest town. A kind older woman driving by stopped when she saw us. We must have looked like a group of escapees, which, in a way, we were. She let us use her phone to call the police. The authorities arrived quickly and arrested Mr. Gray. The evidence in the basement was enough to link him to several missing persons cases. He had used the mansion as a perfect crime scene, luring guests who would never be heard from again. We gave our statements, each of us recounting the horrifying events. The police assured us that Mr. Gray would face justice, but the experience left us all deeply shaken. Back in the city, I couldn't stop thinking about how close we had come to becoming his next victims. The mansion, once a symbol of luxury and escape, had turned into a nightmare. We learned the hard way that safety is an illusion, and that sometimes the most beautiful places can hide the darkest secrets. As we went our separate ways, we made a pact to always be cautious about where we stayed and whom we trusted. The memory of that weekend would haunt us forever, a grim reminder of the fragility of life and the importance of vigilance. I arrived at the rustic cabin nestled deep in the Great Smoky Mountains, near Gatlinburg, Tennessee, with high hopes for a peaceful retreat. The late October foliage painted the landscape in vibrant hues of red and gold, an idyllic setting for my creative escape. As a 32-year-old freelance writer, I longed for solitude to work on my novel. Greg, the host, greeted me warmly. An overly friendly man in his 50s, he gave me a quick tour of the cabin. He highlighted its old-world charm and the tranquility it offered, perfect for creative work, he said. But I noticed he glossed over certain parts of the property, particularly the basement. I didn't think much of it at the time, eager to settle in and enjoy the stunning views from the windows. That first night, I settled into the cozy living room. The crackling fireplace provided a comforting backdrop as I began outlining my novel. The tranquility, however, was soon disrupted by faint noises outside. I dismissed them as forest animals or the house settling, but an uneasy feeling began to creep in. While making tea, I noticed strange carvings on the coffee table, odd symbols, and the faint words, "Help me." I attributed them to previous renters and tried to brush off the unease, convincing myself it was just harmless graffiti. The next morning, I decided to explore the cabin more thoroughly. I discovered more carvings and messages hidden in inconspicuous places, under the bed, on the inside of the closet door, even carved into the wooden beams. The messages included phrases like, "Don't trust him," and more of the strange symbols I couldn't decipher. Feeling unnerved, I called Greg. He reassured me it was just the work of bored teenagers, his casual dismissal doing little to ease my growing discomfort. Still, I tried to focus on my writing, pushing the disturbing discoveries to the back of my mind. Curiosity got the better of me, leading me to the local library in Gatlinburg. There, I began researching the symbols and messages, uncovering stories about Mark, a hiker who had stayed at the cabin 2 months prior and disappeared under mysterious circumstances. Newspaper articles and police reports hinted at foul play, but provided no concrete evidence. Mark's disappearance was shrouded in mystery, with locals whispering about the cabin's dark history. Determined to find out more, I felt a growing sense of dread, but also a need to uncover the truth. That night, as I tried to focus on my writing, the noises intensified. I heard footsteps outside, followed by shadows moving past the windows. Panic set in as I locked all the doors and windows, but the noises persisted, now seeming to come from inside the cabin. My heart pounded as I listened to the creaking floorboards and faint whispers. I spent a sleepless night clutching a kitchen knife, every sound amplifying my fear. The next day, while searching for clues, I discovered a hidden compartment in the bedroom. Inside, I found Mark's journal, detailing his own terrifying experiences at the cabin. He wrote about Greg acting strangely and feeling watched, just as I had. The journal mentioned a hidden room in the basement that Greg never spoke of. My hands trembled as I read Mark's final entries, describing his growing fear and suspicion of Greg. Determined to find the hidden room, I steeled myself for what I might uncover. Summoning my courage, I ventured into the basement. I found a concealed door leading to a room filled with disturbing photos and belongings of past guests. The horror of the situation dawned on me as I realized the extent of Greg's sinister activities. At that moment, Greg arrived, his demeanor shifting from friendly to menacing as he saw what I had discovered. "You shouldn't have come here," he hissed. Fear turned to adrenaline as I fought to escape, dodging his grasp and sprinting through the forest. I stumbled onto the main road, flagging down a passing car and urging the driver to call the police. I provided the authorities with Mark's journal and the evidence I found. The police searched the cabin, arresting Greg and uncovering his gruesome secrets. Multiple disappearances were finally explained, but the nightmare was far from over. Back in Atlanta, I received an anonymous package containing a photo of myself taken during my stay at the cabin. The chilling implication was clear. An accomplice remained at large. My harrowing story was published, bringing attention to the dangers I faced and the unresolved elements of the case. Though I continued my writing career, the experience left me haunted, constantly looking over my shoulder. The cabin was shut down, but rumors persisted about the lingering presence of those who vanished there. I could never shake the feeling that someone was watching me, a sinister reminder of my time in the secluded cabin. My best friend Josh and I had been planning our weekend getaway for months. We needed a break from our stressful jobs, and the idea of renting a secluded farmhouse in the countryside seemed perfect. The photos on Airbnb showed a charming, rustic home surrounded by rolling hills and dense woods. It looked like the ideal place to relax and unwind. We arrived at the farmhouse on a Friday afternoon. The drive had been long, but the scenery was beautiful. As we pulled up the gravel driveway, the house came into view. It was just as picturesque as the photos had suggested. We parked the car, grabbed our bags, and headed inside. The interior was cozy and welcoming, with exposed wooden beams and a large stone fireplace. After unpacking, we decided to explore the property. There was a small barn out back, a chicken coop, and a sprawling meadow that led into the woods. The air was fresh, and the only sounds were the chirping of birds and the rustling of leaves. That evening, we sat on the porch with beers in hand, watching the sun set over the horizon. It was peaceful, and for the first time in weeks, I felt truly relaxed. As darkness fell, we headed inside to make dinner. The kitchen was well stocked, and soon the aroma of cooking filled the air. After dinner, we decided to watch a movie. We settled into the living room, and I noticed that our phones had no signal. "Guess we really are in the middle of nowhere," Josh said, laughing. "Yeah, but that's the point, right?" "No distractions," I replied, trying to ignore the slight unease I felt at being so cut off. The first strange noise came around midnight. We were halfway through our movie when we heard a faint thud coming from outside. Josh paused the movie, and we both listened intently. The noise didn't come again, so we shrugged it off and resumed watching. An hour later, just as we were about to head to bed, we heard it again, this time louder and closer. It sounded like something hitting the side of the house. We exchanged nervous glances. "I'll go check it out," Josh said, grabbing a flashlight. I followed him to the front door, and we stepped outside. The air was cool, and the night was pitch black except for the beam of Josh's flashlight. We walked around the house, scanning the area. Everything seemed normal, and we couldn't find anything that could have caused the noise. "Probably just an animal," Josh said, though he didn't sound entirely convinced. We went back inside, locked the doors, and headed to our respective bedrooms. I lay in bed, staring at the ceiling, unable to shake the feeling that something wasn't right. Eventually, exhaustion took over, and I fell asleep. I woke up to the sound of footsteps. They were faint but unmistakable, coming from somewhere inside the house. I glanced at my phone, still no signal. Heart pounding, I crept out of bed and opened my door just enough to peer into the hallway. Josh was already there, looking as alarmed as I felt. "You heard it too," I whispered. He nodded. "Stay here, I'll check it out." "No way, I'm coming with you," I insisted. We moved quietly down the hall, checking each room. The farmhouse was eerily silent, but the sense of unease grew stronger. When we reached the living room, Josh's flashlight beam caught something that made my blood run cold. The front door was wide open. "We locked that," Josh said, his voice tight with fear. Before I could respond, we heard another noise, this time from the kitchen. It sounded like someone rifling through drawers. We ducked behind the couch, trying to come up with a plan. "We need to get out of here," I whispered. "To the car." Josh nodded, and we started to move toward the back door, hoping to avoid whoever was in the kitchen. As we reached the door, I glanced back and saw a shadowy figure moving in the hallway. My heart raced, and I urged Josh to hurry. We burst out the back door and sprinted to the car. Josh fumbled with the keys, and my heart sank as I saw the headlights flash but no engine start. "It's not working," he said, panic in his voice. "Try again," I urged, but it was no use. The car wouldn't start. We looked back at the house, seeing the figure step out onto the porch, illuminated by the porch light. There were more of them, three, maybe four men, all dressed in dark clothes. "We need to hide," I said, pulling Josh toward the barn. We dashed inside and closed the door as quietly as we could. The barn was dark and musty, filled with old tools and hay bales. We found a ladder leading to the loft and climbed up, hoping it would be a safe place to hide. We sat in the dark, listening to the sounds of footsteps outside. I prayed they wouldn't find us. My mind raced with thoughts of what they wanted and why they were here. The realization that our phones had no signal felt even more ominous now. Suddenly, the barn door creaked open. I held my breath, clutching a rusty pitchfork I'd found. The intruders' flashlights swept across the barn, and I could hear them talking in low voices. "They must be around here somewhere," one of them said. "Find them." The footsteps grew closer, and I felt a surge of panic. I looked at Josh, who was gripping an old shovel, his face pale. We had to do something. As the intruders began climbing the ladder, I knew we had to act. I swung the pitchfork at the first man's head, knocking him off balance. He fell with a thud, and Josh hit the second man with the shovel. The other two scrambled back, shouting in surprise. "Run!" I yelled, and we bolted down the ladder and out of the barn. We sprinted toward the woods, the sounds of our pursuers close behind. My lungs burned, and my legs felt like they would give out, but we kept running. We finally reached a small clearing and collapsed, trying to catch our breath. The night was eerily silent again, but we could hear the distant shouts of the intruders searching for us. "We need to keep moving," Josh said, pulling me to my feet. "We have to find help." We stumbled through the woods, guided only by the moonlight. After what felt like hours, we saw lights in the distance. A farmhouse. We made our way to the house, pounding on the door and praying someone would answer. An elderly couple opened the door, their faces filled with concern. We quickly explained what had happened, and they led us inside, locking the door behind us. The woman handed us a phone, and for the first time, I felt a glimmer of hope as I dialed 911. The police arrived within minutes, and we led them back to the farmhouse. The intruders were gone, but the evidence of their break-in was clear. The officers took our statements and assured us they would investigate. Exhausted and shaken, Josh and I were taken to a nearby motel to spend the rest of the night. We didn't sleep, too haunted by the events of the night. The next day, we retrieved our belongings from the farmhouse and headed back to the city. The police later informed us that the intruders were part of a gang targeting isolated vacation homes. They had been watching us from the moment we arrived, cutting off our phone signal and sabotaging our car. It was a chilling reminder of how vulnerable we were in that secluded place. The experience left us both traumatized, and it took a long time for us to feel safe again. We never spoke of returning to that farmhouse, and our weekend getaways were forever changed. The memory of that night remains a stark reminder of how quickly a peaceful retreat can turn into a fight for survival. I arrived at the cabin just as the sun was dipping below the horizon, casting a golden glow over the forested mountains. The Airbnb listing had promised tranquility and inspiration, and as I stepped out of the car and stretched, I felt a sense of peace wash over me. The cabin was quaint, nestled between tall pine trees, with a breathtaking view of the mountains. Mrs. Porter, an elderly woman with a kind smile, met me at the door. She handed me the keys and gave a brief tour of the cabin, pointing out the essentials. As we stood on the porch, she gestured towards a patch of trees. "There's an old house down that way," she said, her voice dropping to a whisper. "It's abandoned and unsafe. Best to stay away from it." I nodded, promising to heed her warning. After she left, I unpacked and settled in, excited to start my writing project. As night fell, I heard strange noises outside, rustling leaves, twigs snapping, but I dismissed them as normal forest sounds. Exhausted from the drive, I went to bed early, unaware of the unease that would soon creep into my stay. I woke early, energized and ready to write. The cabin's cozy atmosphere was perfect for inspiration, and I made good progress on my project. In the afternoon, I decided to take a break and explore the surroundings. The air was crisp and fresh as I walked through the woods. I felt a strange sensation, as if someone was watching me. I shrugged it off, attributing it to my overactive imagination. However, as I approached the dilapidated house Mrs. Porter had warned me about, I heard faint whispers and footsteps behind me. Turning around quickly, I saw no one. My heart raced, and I hurried back to the cabin, locking all the doors and windows. The feeling of being watched lingered, casting a shadow over my evening. Despite my unease, I managed to get some writing done before going to bed. The next morning, I noticed something odd. Items in the cabin had been moved. My laptop was not where I had left it, and a chair was slightly out of place. I tried to brush it off, but a sense of dread settled in my stomach. That night, the knocking on the windows began. Soft at first, then more insistent. My pulse quickened, but I forced myself to stay calm. Determined to uncover the source, I set up a camera in the living room, hoping to capture any unusual activity while I slept. Reviewing the footage the next morning, I felt a chill run down my spine. A shadowy figure moved around the cabin, pausing to stare directly into the camera for several minutes before disappearing. I felt a wave of nausea as fear gripped me. I called Mrs. Porter, but there was no answer. Panic rising, I contacted the local police. They arrived within the hour, inspecting the cabin thoroughly but finding no signs of forced entry. They suggested I might be imagining things due to isolation, but I knew what I had seen. That night, the noises returned, louder and more persistent. Driven by a mix of fear and curiosity, I decided to follow them. They led me to the basement, where I discovered a hidden door behind a stack of old boxes. The door opened to a narrow, dark tunnel. I hesitated, my heart pounding. But then I stepped inside, driven by the need to uncover the truth. The tunnel connected to the abandoned house. Inside, I found clothes, food, and a wall covered in photographs of me, taken from inside the cabin. Terrified, I ran back to the cabin, my mind racing. When I reached the living room, Mrs. Porter was there, waiting for me. Mrs. Porter's face was grim. She revealed that her mentally unstable son had been living in the abandoned house and had become obsessed with me. Before I could react, he appeared, wild-eyed and furious. A struggle ensued and I barely managed to escape, driving frantically to the nearest town. The police were quick to respond, and both Mrs. Porter and her son were arrested. The ordeal was over, but the fear lingered. I returned home, deeply shaken. The experience had left scars that wouldn't heal easily. I decided to take a break from freelance writing and seek therapy to cope with the trauma. Just when I thought I could move on, a letter arrived with no return address. Inside was a single photograph of me, looking out the window of the cabin. The terror I thought I'd escaped came rushing back, leaving me with the haunting realization that some nightmares never truly end. I rented out an Airbnb in Northern California for a much-needed break. I don't go on many trips out of town, so this was one of the few times I've had to stay somewhere, other than a friend or family member's house. The area I needed to stay in was small, and most of the hotels didn't look very nice. To my surprise, there was a single home listed on Airbnb. It was my first time using the site, but the house looked like a decent place, much better than the hotels. I requested the dates, and in a few minutes the place was booked. The following week, I started the drive. When I got to the town, which was about 14 hours from my city, it was well into the night. The town almost looked deserted compared to where I was used to living. All the houses' lights were off, and all the stores were closed. No people or cars were out. Of course, it was the middle of the night, so I didn't expect this small town to be lit up and active at this time, but it was still eerie considering I hadn't seen it during the day. I only came in with this as the first impression. The street that took me to the Airbnb was dark as well, leading through a winding, forested neighborhood until I eventually ended up at the house. It was one of few that had its porch and outdoor lights on, but one window upstairs had a light coming through it as well. I figured the last guest had just made the mistake of leaving it on, so I thought nothing of it and started getting my stuff up to the front door. I got the key code from my email and opened the door, getting inside and locking the door behind me. I quickly put my stuff in the corner of the room, then went upstairs to turn off the light that was left on. It was one of the spare bedrooms, only having a bed and a small dresser in it. I flicked it off, then went to the main bedroom to set up my things. I was only staying for one night, but had it booked for two because I needed to be there late into the following day. I was up for no more than an hour before finally getting in bed and turning in for the night. I rested my eyes and tried to sleep, but was laying awake for a long time. I sat up quickly, hearing a thud run through the walls of the house. I stared at the door, trying to think what could have been the cause of the sound, but with no ideas coming to mind, I got up to check. I opened the door softly, peering into the upstairs hallway. It was dark and quiet now. No more thuds, only the sounds of the house swaying in the wind. I stepped back and quietly shut the door, but a strange feeling came to me that had me wait as I thought more about the sound I heard. As I stood there, soft creaks started to go along the floorboards from the other room. I listened with my ear against the door as the creaking moved into the hallway and then began making its way toward the door. I was so in shock that I almost didn't realize that it had to be footsteps of someone approaching. My heart started racing as they came right up to the other side of the door. I put my hand tightly on the door handle to keep it from moving, and only a moment later, I felt it pull down. As soon as I resisted, they eased off. There was a small moment before suddenly the handle was forced down, and they slammed into the door. It swung half open before I pressed my body back into it. I only saw half of their face in the doorway, but in their eyes was an anger that I didn't expect to ever see. After a struggle, I somehow managed to push the door back into the latch and lock it. The man on the other side tried to get it back open, but after yelling a few unpleasant words towards me, he ran downstairs and out of the house. I was still catching my breath, and my mind was racing. But I gathered myself up and dialed 911. For such a small town, they came shortly after. The owner of the Airbnb continued with the case after I left the following day, but I wish I had kept up with it. That man seemed so desperate to get into my room and was in some state of rage, like he wanted to hurt me as if I'd done something to him. Everything about it is disturbing, and I don't think I'll ever get it out of my head, but Airbnbs probably won't be something I take part in again for a long time. I had been looking forward to the week-long conference in the bustling city for months. Renting a modern loft through Airbnb seemed like the perfect way to enjoy a change of scenery and get some inspiration for my writing. The loft was everything I hoped for. Spacious, bright, and located in a vibrant neighborhood filled with cafes, boutiques, and street performers. On my first night, after a long day of networking and attending panels, I decided to unwind with a glass of wine on the balcony. As I gazed at the city lights, I noticed someone entering the building across the street. My heart skipped a beat. The woman looked exactly like me. Same dark hair, same height, even wearing a similar outfit. I blinked, convinced my tired eyes were playing tricks on me, and dismissed it as a strange coincidence. The next morning I woke early, eager to explore the city before the conference resumed. I grabbed a coffee from the cafe on the corner and strolled through a nearby park. I froze when I saw her again, sitting on a bench, reading a book. She glanced up and our eyes met. A chill ran down my spine. The resemblance was uncanny. I turned quickly and walked away, feeling unnerved. As the days went by, I began to see the doppelganger more frequently. She seemed to be everywhere, at the conference, in the supermarket, even at the gym I visited one morning. Each time she was doing something I had done just hours before, wearing clothes eerily similar to mine. It was as if she was mimicking my every move. My unease grew. I started receiving strange messages and calls meant for her, containing cryptic and threatening content. One text read, "You can't hide forever. We know what you did." Another voicemail warned, "Leave now, or face the consequences." My attempts to explain the situation to my friends were met with skepticism. They suggested I was overworked and stressed. One night there was a knock on the door. My heart raced as I approached, peering through the peephole. No one was there, but a package lay on the doormat. I brought it inside and opened it with trembling hands. Inside were photos of me, taken from a distance, capturing me doing everyday activities. There were pictures of me walking to the conference, sitting in the cafe, even lounging in the loft. Panic set in. Someone was stalking me. Desperate for answers, I confronted the building manager. I described the doppelganger and the unsettling occurrences. The manager looked puzzled and assured me that no one else resembling me was staying in the building or the neighborhood. He even offered to check the security footage, but found nothing unusual. That night, the doppelganger appeared inside my loft. I was brushing my teeth when I saw her in the mirror, standing behind me, mimicking my movements exactly. I spun around, but she vanished. I searched the loft, every corner, every closet, but found nothing. My mind was unraveling and I questioned my own sanity. Determined to get to the bottom of this, I researched the history of the loft. I discovered that the previous tenant, a woman named Sarah, had a similar experience. Sarah had documented everything in a journal, which I found hidden behind a loose brick in the wall. She wrote about seeing her doppelganger, receiving threats, and eventually disappearing under mysterious circumstances. The last entry read, "She's getting closer. I can't escape her." I decided to set up a camera to capture evidence of the doppelganger. I positioned it in the living room, aimed at the spot where I had seen her before. That night, she appeared again. I watched in horror as she walked into view of the camera, stared directly into the lens, and then disappeared. Next morning, I checked the footage, but she was not there. My paranoia reached its peak. I barely slept, kept all the lights on, and avoided mirrors. I knew I had to find a way to break free from this nightmare. I returned to Sarah's journal, hoping for a clue. Buried in the final pages was a mention of a ritual, a way to banish the doppelganger. The instructions were cryptic, involving a series of steps that had to be performed at midnight. I gathered the items needed, a mirror, a candle, and a piece of my own clothing. As the clock struck 12, I began the ritual, following the steps meticulously. I lit the candle, stared into the mirror, and chanted the incantation from the journal. At first, nothing happened. Then the air grew cold, and the flame flickered. The doppelganger appeared in the mirror, her eyes filled with malice. My reflection warped, and she stepped out of the mirror, reaching for me. Summoning all my courage, I completed the final step of the ritual, burning the piece of clothing while reciting the last line of the incantation. She screamed, a chilling sound that echoed through the loft. She dissolved into smoke, sucked back into the mirror. The glass shattered, and the room fell silent. I collapsed to the floor, exhausted, but relieved. I had done it. The curse was broken. The next day, I left, vowing never to return. Contacted the Airbnb host, explaining that I had to leave early due to personal reasons. I never mentioned the doppelganger or the ritual, fearing they would think I was insane. I moved to a new city, far away from the haunting memories of that week. I resumed my writing, channeling my fear and experiences into a novel that became an instant bestseller. Yet, every now and then, I would catch a glimpse of a familiar face in a crowd, or see a shadow that seemed too familiar, and a shiver would run down my spine. I knew the doppelganger was gone, but the trauma lingered, a reminder of the thin veil between reality and the supernatural. I learned to live with the shadows, using my story as a cautionary tale of the dangers that lurk in the most unexpected places. I rented an Airbnb in a small town in the Midwest for a week-long getaway. I wanted to escape the hustle and bustle of city life, and the quaint, quiet town seemed like the perfect place. The house was charming and situated at the end of a cul-de-sac, surrounded by thick woods. It looked like an idyllic retreat from the photos on the listing. I arrived in the late afternoon. The sun was setting, casting a warm glow over the town. The house was even more charming in person, with its white picket fence and neatly trimmed lawn. I parked my car in the driveway, grabbed my bags, and headed inside. The host had left a key under the doormat, just as they had mentioned in the check-in instructions. The interior of the house was cozy, with rustic furniture and a fireplace in the living room. After settling in, I decided to take a walk around the neighborhood to stretch my legs and get a feel for the place. As I strolled down the quiet streets, I noticed an elderly man sitting on his porch next door. He waved me over with a friendly smile. "Hello there. You must be the new guest staying at the Airbnb," he said. "Name's Henry. Lived here my whole life." "Hi, I'm Alex," I replied, shaking his hand. "Yes, I'm staying here for the week. It's a beautiful town." Henry nodded. "It is. Quiet and peaceful, just the way we like it. Not many visitors come around here, though. You're one of the few." We chatted for a while, and Henry told me stories about the town's history and the people who lived there. He seemed like a kind old man, full of interesting anecdotes. But then, he mentioned something that piqued my curiosity. "You know, there's been some strange occurrences with that Airbnb you're staying at," he said, lowering his voice. "A few guests have come and gone, but some, well, they just vanished. No one knows what happened to them." I felt a chill run down my spine. "Vanished? What do you mean?" Henry sighed. "It's hard to explain. They checked in just like you did, but never checked out. Their cars were left behind, but they were gone. No trace of them." I tried to brush off the unease that was creeping up on me. "That sounds like something out of a horror movie," I said with a nervous laugh. Henry didn't laugh. "Just be careful, Alex. Keep your wits about you." I thanked him for the warning and headed back to the Airbnb, my mind racing with thoughts of the missing guests. I tried to focus on enjoying my vacation, but Henry's words lingered in my mind. That night I had trouble sleeping. Every creak of the house and rustle of the trees outside seemed amplified in the silence. I told myself it was just my imagination running wild, but I couldn't shake the feeling of being watched. The next morning, I decided to do some research. I visited the local library and looked up any news articles about missing persons in the town. To my surprise, there were indeed several reports of people who had disappeared over the past few years, all of whom had been staying at the same Airbnb. The cases were eerily similar. Guests checked in, but never checked out, leaving behind all their belongings. I returned to the house, my curiosity now fully piqued. I decided to take a closer look around the property. As I explored the backyard, I noticed a small shed tucked away in the corner, almost hidden by overgrown bushes. The door was slightly ajar and a padlock hung loosely from the latch. With a sense of foreboding, I pushed the door open and stepped inside. The shed was filled with old tools and gardening supplies, but what caught my eye was a stack of boxes in the corner. I opened one of the boxes and found personal items, clothing, toiletries, and even a few wallets. My heart pounded as I realized these must have belonged to the missing guests. I took out my phone and snapped some pictures, planning to show them to the police. As I was about to leave the shed, I heard footsteps approaching. I quickly hid behind a stack of crates, my breath shallow and my heart racing. The footsteps stopped outside the shed, and I heard the familiar voice of my host, Mark. "I know you're in there, Alex," he called out, his tone menacing. "You shouldn't have gone snooping around." I felt a surge of panic. How did he know I was there? I tried to stay as still as possible, hoping he would leave. But Mark stepped inside the shed, his eyes scanning the room until they landed on me. "There you are," he said with a cold smile. "You've seen too much." Before I could react, Mark lunged at me. I tried to fend him off, but he was much stronger than he looked. He pinned me to the ground and pulled out a syringe from his pocket. I struggled, but he managed to inject me with a sedative. My vision blurred, and darkness closed in around me. The last thing I heard was Mark's voice, whispering in my ear. "You're not the first, and you won't be the last." When I woke up, I was in a small, windowless room. My hands and feet were bound, and I had no idea where I was. Panic set in as I realized the gravity of my situation. I had to find a way out. I struggled against the ropes, but they were tied tight. Desperation fueled my efforts, and after what felt like hours, I managed to loosen the knots enough to free my hands. I untied my feet and stood up, my legs shaky. The room was bare except for a single door. I pressed my ear against it, listening for any sounds outside. Hearing nothing, I slowly turned the knob and peeked out. The hallway was empty, and I could see a staircase leading up. I crept down the hall and up the stairs, trying to be as quiet as possible. As I reached the top, I found myself in the main part of the house. It was eerily quiet, and I could see the front door just a few feet away. Summoning all my courage, I made a run for it. I burst through the front door and sprinted to my car, fumbling for my keys. As I started the engine, I saw Mark running out of the house, shouting at me to stop. I didn't look back. I sped down the street, my hands trembling on the wheel. I drove straight to the police station and reported everything. The police took my statement and assured me they would investigate. A few days later, I received a call from the police. They had arrested Mark and found more evidence linking him to the disappearances of the other guests. It turned out he had been running a kidnapping ring, using the Airbnb to lure unsuspecting travelers. The news shook me to my core. I couldn't believe how close I had come to becoming another one of his victims. The experience left me traumatized, and it took me a long time to feel safe again. I never used Airbnb again after that. The memories of that week still haunt me, and I can't help but think of the other guests who weren't as lucky as I was. Henry's warning had been more than just a story. It had saved my life. I rented a secluded cabin in the woods of Oregon to work on my book. It was an old, rustic place, perfect for the solitude I needed. As a writer struggling with a severe case of writer's block, I hoped the peace and quiet would spark my creativity. The Airbnb listing boasted about the serene environment and lush forests, which seemed ideal for my retreat. After a long drive, I arrived at the cabin in the late afternoon. The first thing I noticed were the strange symbols carved into the trees and painted on rocks around the property. They looked ancient, maybe Native American, I thought. I dismissed them as local folklore, more curious than concerned. The cabin itself was charming, with a cozy interior that immediately made me feel at home. Shortly after settling in, I received a welcome message from the host. "Welcome, Jacob. Hope you enjoy your stay. Please remember to stay indoors after dark for safety reasons. Feel free to contact me if you need anything." The message was friendly but vague. Safety reasons. I shrugged it off, assuming it was just a precaution against wild animals. That night, as I was preparing dinner, I heard faint chanting in the distance. Curious, I stepped outside and saw distant torchlights flickering in the woods. It sent a chill down my spine, but I convinced myself it was probably just a local event or celebration. I went back inside, locked the door, and tried to focus on my writing. The next night, the chanting returned, louder this time, and the torchlight seemed closer. The rhythmic voices and flickering flames were unsettling, but I tried to ignore them. However, my curiosity got the better of me, and I peeked through the window. To my horror, I saw a group of robed figures moving slowly through the trees, chanting in unison. My heart raced, and I quickly drew the curtains, retreating to the safety of the cabin. I messaged the host about the strange occurrences. Their reply was quick and cryptic. "Don't worry, Jacob. It's just a local tradition. Nothing to be afraid of." Nothing to be afraid of? It was far from reassuring, but I had no choice but to accept it. The following night, the chanting was even louder, and the torchlights were now just beyond the edge of the clearing around the cabin. I stayed indoors, as advised, but my anxiety was growing. Around midnight, I heard footsteps outside. I peered through a crack in the curtains and saw the robed figures surrounding the cabin. They began a ritual, chanting louder and raising their torches high. Suddenly, one of them pulled out a struggling bound figure and forced them to kneel in the center of the circle. I watched in horror as a makeshift altar was set up, and the chanting reached a fever pitch. Before I could react, the robed leader produced a knife and, with a swift motion, sacrificed the victim. I stumbled back from the window, my mind racing. I had to get out of there. I grabbed my phone and called the host, my voice trembling as I recounted what I had seen. The host's response was disturbingly calm. "It's part of our tradition, Jacob. Please stay calm and stay indoors." Terrified, I decided to leave. I packed my things and rushed to my car, but the road was blocked by fallen trees. It was deliberate. There was no way it was a coincidence. Desperate, I tried to start the car, but it wouldn't start. Someone had tampered with it. I was trapped. I returned to the cabin, barricading myself inside. I noticed a trapdoor under the rug in the living room leading to a hidden basement. With no other options, I descended into the dark, hoping to find a way out, or at least some place to hide. The basement was filled with cult artifacts, masks, robes, books with strange symbols, and an altar similar to the one outside. Panic set in as I realized the cabin wasn't just a rental. It was a sanctuary for the cult's leader. I had stumbled into their sacred ground. I needed to find a way to escape before they returned. Hours passed, and the chanting resumed above me. I could hear them searching the cabin. I stayed as quiet as possible, praying they wouldn't find the trap door. I noticed a small window high up on the basement wall, just big enough to crawl through. Gathering my courage, I climbed up and squeezed through the window, dropping into the cold night air outside. I ran through the woods, following the faint trails illuminated by the moonlight. I could hear the cultists behind me, their chanting growing louder as they realized I had escaped. My heart pounded as I pushed myself to keep running, the trees and underbrush tearing at my clothes and skin. Eventually, I found a road and flagged down a passing car. The driver, an elderly man, looked at me with concern as I breathlessly explained what had happened. He drove me to the nearest town, where I called the police. The authorities investigated the cabin, but by the time they arrived, the cult had vanished, leaving no trace behind. The symbols, the artifacts, and even the bodies were gone. The host, too, was nowhere to be found. The police dismissed my story as a figment of my imagination, a result of stress and isolation. I left Oregon, never to return. The experience haunted me, and I abandoned my book project, unable to shake the memories of that night. The symbols, the chanting, the sacrifice, it all stayed with me, a dark reminder of the horrors that lurk just beyond the edge of civilization. I rented an old, charming house in a historic district for a romantic getaway with my girlfriend, Emily. We were both history buffs, so staying in a place with a rich past was exciting. Upon arrival, we were greeted by an overly friendly but peculiar elderly neighbor named Mr. Thompson. He eagerly shared stories about the house's dark history, including a famous unsolved murder that took place there decades ago. Back in the 1920s, a young woman named Clara was found dead in this very house. They never caught the killer, he said, with a gleam in his eye. We thanked him for the information, though it made us slightly uneasy. We brushed it off as part of the house's charm. The first night, as we were getting ready for bed, we heard unsettling noises, creaks and groans that seemed to come from within the walls. Old houses make noise, I reassured Emily, though I wasn't entirely convinced myself. The shadows cast by the flickering street lamp outside seemed to dance eerily on the walls. The next day, we decided to explore the attic. Amidst the old furniture and dusty boxes, we found an old diary. It belonged to Clara, the woman who was murdered. Her entries were filled with paranoia, describing how she felt someone was always watching her. I saw him again today, lurking outside my window, one entry read. Emily shivered as she read it aloud. That night, the noises grew louder, and we started finding messages written in the dust on surfaces, warning us to leave. "Get out," was scrawled on the bathroom mirror, and "He's here," was etched into the dust on the kitchen counter. Fear began to set in, but we tried to rationalize it. Maybe it was just our minds playing tricks on us. Around midnight, we were startled awake by the sound of the back door creaking open and footsteps in the hallway. My eyes widened, and I grabbed the baseball bat I had brought just in case. Emily clung to me, trembling. Gathering my courage, I swung the bedroom door open and was met with nothing but an empty hallway. We decided to stay up for the rest of the night, taking turns keeping watch. Around 3 a.m., we saw Mr. Thompson standing inside our house, holding a candle. "I'm here to protect you," he whispered. "The killer still roams these parts." Emily and I exchanged a horrified glance. "You need to leave," I said, my voice shaking. Mr. Thompson insisted he was there to help, but his presence only made things worse. We decided to leave immediately. We packed our bags and rushed out to our car, but it wouldn't start. Panic set in. Mr. Thompson stood on his porch, watching us with a strange smile. "You can't escape him," he called out. Desperate, I dialed the police. They arrived within minutes, and Mr. Thompson retreated into his house. The police managed to jumpstart our car and followed us to a nearby motel. We spent the night there, too terrified to sleep. The next day, we contacted the Airbnb host and told them everything. They were shocked and promised to investigate. Weeks later, we learned that Mr. Thompson had a history of mental illness and was indeed the prime suspect in Clara's murder. He had been living next door for years, convincing himself he was protecting others from a non-existent killer. Emily and I never returned to that house, but the memory of that terrifying night still haunts us. The charm of history was replaced with a chilling reminder that some pasts are better left undisturbed.
When Alex and I first saw the listing for our new home, we couldn't believe our luck. A sprawling 1920s farmhouse, nestled on the outskirts of town, priced as if it were begging for buyers. The real estate agent had mentioned a motivated seller, but as we drove down the long gravel driveway lined with ancient oaks, it felt more like a hidden gem than a desperate sale. The house sat on a slight hill, its white paint faded to a ghostly gray, shutters hanging a touch askew. There was an undeniable charm to it, a story waiting to be told. "It's perfect," Alex had whispered, squeezing my hand with a grin as wide as the horizon beyond our new backyard. I returned his smile, my heart swelling with dreams of what could be. In the first few days of renovation, It became a game to peel back the layers of the house's past. Underneath wallpaper that bloomed with faded roses, we found hints of its century-old skeleton, horsehair plaster, lathe walls, and yes, even peeling lead paint. Each discovery was met with a mix of excitement and mild concern. "They sure don't make them like they used to," Alex joked as he pried up floorboards, revealing asbestos tiles beneath. We laughed it off, caught up in visions of restoring the home to its former glory. But as we tore down old paneling and sanded floors, an unsettling silence settled over the house. It was as if the walls were holding their breath, watching us with the weary eyes of the past. Evenings were the eeriest. The wind whispered through the cracks, carrying the cold and lonely sounds of the countryside. We should have felt isolated, maybe even scared, but we were too enamored with our project, too wrapped up in the potential of our new life to heed the silent warnings. Little did we know, the real story of our home was buried, not in its walls, but in the ground beneath it. As the renovations progressed, so did an inexplicable feeling of discomfort. At first, Alex and I chalked it up to the long hours and dust clouds billowing from our work. Coughs and headaches became our constant, uninvited companions, and nights were restless with a fatigue that seemed too heavy for our youthful bodies. "It's just the stress," I muttered one evening, rubbing my temples as Alex nodded, his eyes red from more than just the dust. Our concerns spilled over during a trip to the local hardware store, where we hoped to find solace in conversation and practical advice. As we listed our symptoms to the elderly store owner, Mr. Jenkins, his face grew increasingly darker. "You know, this land wasn't always just farmland," he began, his voice lowering. "Back in the day, it was all industrial. Plants and factories, some of them not too careful with what they left behind." His words hung in the air, heavier than the humid summer heat. With a grave look, he added, "Might want to check your soil before going any further. Just to be safe." His advice felt like a cold splash of reality. On our drive home, the countryside didn't seem quite as charming. Each rusted farm tool and overgrown field appeared as a testament to a forgotten, possibly sinister past. Taking Mr. Jenkins's warning to heart, Alex and I arranged for environmental specialists to test the soil surrounding our home. The waiting was agony, filled with unease and whispered fears. When the results finally came, they confirmed our worst fears. High levels of lead were just the beginning. The reports also detailed a slew of other industrial toxins, including a mysterious compound that the specialists couldn't immediately identify. "Could this be why the house was so cheap?" Alex asked, voice tight with anxiety. The question loomed large in the dusty air of our unfinished living room, unanswered, but increasingly obvious. Our dream home was turning into a nightmare, and the ground beneath it held secrets that were literally surfacing in our lives. Filled with a growing sense of duty, Alex and I organized a community meeting at the local town hall. We felt it was critical to share what we'd uncovered, fearing the scope of the contamination might extend beyond the borders of our property. The turnout was more significant than we had anticipated, with faces old and young reflecting a mix of curiosity and concern. As we presented our findings, the room's atmosphere thickened with tension and disbelief. After our presentation, a longtime resident, Mrs. Harrow, stood up. Her voice trembled as she recounted how her husband had succumbed to a mysterious illness years ago, one that doctors couldn't quite explain. One by one, others shared similar stories of chronic illnesses, unexplained ailments, and even deaths. The pattern was chilling, and a wave of anger and fear swept through the room. The gravity of our situation had just begun to sink in when the real opposition made itself known. The following days turned darker. It started with an anonymous letter slipped under our door, stark against the morning light. "Stop digging where you don't belong." Dismissing it as a scare tactic, we tried to press on, but when our car was found with its tires slashed and a warning scratched into the paint, the message was clear. The worst came when our beloved dog Buster didn't come home one evening. We searched everywhere, our calls growing frantic as night fell. He was more than a pet. He was family, and his disappearance left a hollow fear in our hearts. The message was unmistakable. Someone powerful wanted us to back down, and they were willing to hurt us to make it happen. Despite the shadow of threats that loomed over us, Alex and I knew we couldn't retreat into silence. We reached out to the other affected neighbors, forging a coalition of the determined and the wronged. Among our newfound allies was Dr. Elise Moran, a local physician who had long suspected environmental causes behind the peculiar patterns of illness in our community. Together, we began documenting the health impacts systematically, compiling data and personal accounts into a compelling body of evidence. Dr. Moran organized health screenings, and her findings were stark. "There's a clear link between these symptoms and the toxins you found," she confirmed during one of our strategy meetings. Her professional affirmation galvanized the group, and our mission felt more justified than ever. We weren't just fighting for our property values or peace of mind anymore. This was about our very lives. Our efforts culminated in another community meeting, this time charged with the urgency of our findings. The hall was packed, the air crackling with tension and anticipation. Midway through the meeting, as another resident shared a particularly emotional testimony, a heated exchange broke out on the floor. Accusations flew, fingers pointed, and in that heated moment, a startling revelation surfaced. Mark, a member of the community board, was exposed for his clandestine communications with BioCorp, the corporation suspected of the initial pollution. Emails leaked by an anonymous source revealed his attempts to downplay our concerns and mislead the investigation. The betrayal was a harsh blow, shattering the fragile trust within our ranks. The room erupted into chaos, voices raised not only in anger but also in betrayal and fear. Yet as the initial shock faded, a resolute determination settled among us. Mark's treachery, rather than deterring us, only bound us closer together. With the mole revealed, we knew the lengths to which our adversaries would go. It was a declaration of war against our community's health and future, and we were more determined than ever to fight back. Our opportunity came when a whistleblower from BioCorp, moved by our plight and disgusted by the company's disregard for human life, reached out to us. She provided damning documents and emails that detailed decades of illegal dumping and deliberate cover-up of the contamination. Armed with this irrefutable evidence, we approached a seasoned environmental lawyer who specialized in corporate malfeasance. He was appalled by the extent of the wrongdoing and took on our case with a fervent zeal. Simultaneously, we contacted Carla Mendez, a tenacious local journalist known for her investigative prowess. When she published the first article detailing our story, complete with leaked documents and personal accounts, it sent shockwaves throughout the state. The media exposure was immediate and overwhelming. Other news outlets picked up the story, amplifying our plight into a national scandal. Public outcry grew, forcing regulatory bodies to step in. As the legal proceedings began, BioCorp faced mounting pressure from all sides. The evidence was too compelling, the public and legal scrutiny too intense for them to escape accountability. After months of grueling legal battles, the case concluded with a substantial victory for our community. BioCorp was ordered to pay a significant settlement to the affected residents, acknowledging their decades of suffering. Furthermore, the court mandated a comprehensive cleanup of the area. Funded by the corporation, but overseen by state environmental agencies to ensure compliance and transparency. As the news of the settlement broke, our community felt a collective relief. There was a sense of vindication, of justice finally being served after years of silent suffering. While the scars of our ordeal would remain, the resolution brought hope. We had not only secured a safer environment, but it also affirmed the power of community resilience and the impact of standing united against seemingly insurmountable odds. Tom and I had always been adventurers at heart, so when we found a house up for sale that had once hosted elaborate escape room games, it seemed like fate. It was our chance to merge our love for puzzles and mysteries with our new beginning. The house was perfect, sprawling, with an air of mystery, and nestled on the edge of town, where the whispers of its past could still be felt in the ornate, slightly dusty corners of each room. Our exploration led us to a peculiar room at the end of a long hallway. Unlike the rest of the house, this room was heavily themed, like stepping into another world. A captain's quarters on a pirate ship, complete with a sturdy wooden desk, nautical maps, and a large, ominous-looking chest. As we ventured in, marveling at the detail, the door clicked shut behind us with a definitive, automated sound. A quick test confirmed our suspicion. It locked automatically, and we were now unwitting participants in the last active game of the house. the thrill of discovery mixed with a hint of foreboding, as we realized that escaping this room might require more than just a love for adventure. Tom's curiosity often led him ahead of me, and that day was no different. He had wandered into the themed room alone while I was still admiring an old portrait in the hallway. Suddenly, a sharp click echoed down the corridor, the sound of a door locking. Alarmed, I hurried towards the sound, reaching the room just as Tom pushed against the door from the inside, his face confused and slightly pale. "Sarah, it just locked itself," he called out, his voice muffled through the thick wood. Without thinking, I pushed the door open and stepped inside to help him, but no sooner had I crossed the threshold than the door slammed shut behind me, the lock clicking with a finality that made my heart skip. We exchanged a look of disbelief. Now, both trapped, the game was not just a pastime. It was a necessity. We needed to solve whatever puzzle lay ahead to find our way out. As Tom and I began assessing our surroundings, the initial puzzles presented themselves almost playfully. They involved a series of riddles and physical tasks, like aligning the compasses and flags according to the nautical maps that adorned the walls. Working together, we found our rhythm, each puzzle pushing us to think logically and rely on each other's strengths. The solutions led to hidden compartments in the room, revealing keys and cryptic notes that directed us to the next challenge. However, as we delved deeper into the heart of the room's mysteries, the tone shifted dramatically. We discovered a hidden monitor behind a panel on the wall, and when activated, it played grainy black and white video recordings. These were the previous occupants, couples, friends, individuals, all looking increasingly desperate and scared, some never shown leaving the room. The realization that not all had escaped sent a chill down my spine. The puzzles escalated, not just in difficulty but in danger. One involved bypassing a system of wires that, if touched incorrectly, triggered a mild electric shock. This wasn't just about fun and games. It was a test of endurance and nerve. Scattered among the props, we found academic papers and notes from someone who called himself the Watcher, detailing observations on human behavior under extreme stress. It was clear that this room was an experiment in psychological research, designed by someone with a deep, if not disturbing, interest in pushing human limits. Drawing on my background in psychology, I tried to think like the creator of this twisted game. This Watcher was not just a puzzle master. He seemed to be a reclusive genius, using this setup to study fear, stress, and resilience. Each puzzle was crafted to heighten anxiety and force quick, stressful decision-making. "Tom," I said, pausing to gather my thoughts, "these aren't just puzzles. They're manipulations designed to break us down psychologically. We need to keep our wits and remember it's all just a test." Understanding this, we approached each new challenge with a renewed perspective, not just solving puzzles, but also unraveling the mindset of the disturbed mind that had laid them out. This insight gave us a slight edge, keeping us one step ahead of panic as we prepared to face whatever came next. The puzzles morphed from intellectually challenging to physically perilous. One harrowing task involved a large mechanical contraption in the center of the room, its gears silently menacing. It was set with a timer, ticking down ominously, and linked to a series of levers and switches. The wrong move could potentially trigger a mechanism designed to snap shut, possibly causing severe injury. Tom and I studied the contraption, our minds racing against time. The solution involved a complex sequence of actions that needed to be executed perfectly. We had to rely completely on our trust in each other, as one misstep could have disastrous consequences. Our hands trembled as we carefully aligned each component, the sound of the ticking timer echoing in our ears. With seconds to spare, we pulled the final lever, and the device deactivated with a shuddering clang, the immediate danger averted. Breathing a sigh of relief, I noticed something peculiar. A small, almost imperceptible red light blinking from the corner of the room. A hidden camera was embedded in the wall, its lens fixed directly on us. It dawned on us then that our every move, every expression of fear or relief, was likely being monitored. This was more than a simple game. It was an ongoing experiment observing how we coped with extreme stress. The thought that someone might still be orchestrating these events from the shadows, watching our every move, added a chilling new layer to our predicament. This was not just a fight for freedom, it was a battle under the watchful eye of an unseen observer, making the stakes all the more real and terrifying. As we progressed, the sense of urgency became palpable. Hidden beneath the layers of nautical charts, Tom uncovered a digital display embedded into the captain's desk, its red digits counting down with ruthless precision. We hadn't noticed it before, masked by the room's elaborate decor. But now it was impossible to ignore. The clock was ticking down to what we feared was a permanent sealing of the room. The reality that we could be trapped here indefinitely set our nerves on edge. With less than an hour left, we were forced to accelerate our pace. Each puzzle became a frantic race against time. I leaned into my understanding of psychological tactics, predicting the sequence of the puzzles based on the stress and decision-making models I'd studied. This room, this game, was designed to overwhelm and disorient its players, pushing them to their mental limits. Tom, with his knack for mechanics, became invaluable. His hands moved with precision over the intricate locking mechanisms and trap setups. At one point, a wrong calculation nearly triggered a ceiling panel to close down on us, but Tom's quick reflexes and technical acumen reversed the mechanism just in time. Our combined efforts were our greatest strength. We were striving not just to escape, but to outsmart the creator of this macabre experiment. As we solved each successive puzzle, the looming threat of the room's final lockdown motivated us to push through fear and fatigue, inching closer to what we hoped would be our escape. The final puzzle was the culmination of everything we had encountered so far, a complex cipher that sprawled across the room's far wall, composed of symbols and equations that seemed indecipherable at first glance. The digits on the countdown clock bled away as Tom and I threw ourselves into solving it, our minds weaving together threads of logic and intuition. As I decoded the symbols using patterns we'd noticed in earlier challenges, Tom tackled the mathematical side, his calculations a rapid whisper in the tense air. Finally, with mere minutes ticking down, we aligned the last symbol with its counterpart, triggering a soft click from the wall. Hidden behind a false panel, we found the manual override, a simple switch, unassuming yet powerful. I flipped it, holding my breath, and with a deep grinding noise, the door unlocked, swinging open to our freedom. The relief was palpable, mixed with a triumph that surged through our exhausted spirits. As the door swung open, revealing the familiar hallway of our house, Tom and I stumbled out, our bodies and minds weary from the ordeal. The quiet of the home felt surreal after the relentless ticking and mechanical sounds of the escape room. We leaned against each other for support, grateful for our escape, but deeply shaken by the experience. Our immediate relief was quickly overshadowed by a resolve to understand the full extent of what had happened. Who had designed these puzzles with such malicious intent? Why were we chosen? We knew our journey wasn't over. It had merely shifted into a new phase of seeking answers and ensuring no one else would endure such a terrifying ordeal. In the days that followed, Tom and I worked with the police, combing through property records and the previous owner's belongings left in the attic. It became clear that our backgrounds in psychology and engineering hadn't just influenced our decision to buy the house. They had made us targets for the twisted research designed by the previous owner. The house hadn't found us by accident. But as we pieced together the chilling puzzle, a new, anonymous message arrived. Congratulations on passing the final test. The real experiment begins now. The words sent a cold shiver down my spine. Our escape had been only a prelude, suggesting that our true challenges lay ahead, masterminded by someone who was still watching, still orchestrating from the shadows. The day we moved into the new apartment felt like a fresh start, a slice of the dream we'd been chasing for so long. Our new home was a spacious two-bedroom apartment bathed in sunlight, with a view overlooking a small, bustling park. Emily and I were overjoyed. We could already imagine our daughter Lily growing up here, making friends in the playground below. It was our little piece of paradise in the chaos of the city. As we started unpacking, a pile of unopened mail caught my attention, stacked neatly on the entryway table. It was all addressed to a Michael Harrow. We assumed forwarding his mail would be a simple act of courtesy, a final gesture to the apartment's previous tenant. But when I took the stack to the post office, the clerk's brow furrowed with confusion as she typed Michael's name into her system. "I'm sorry," she said, glancing up at me with a hint of concern. "But there's no forwarding address left for him. It's like he just vanished." Her words sent a chill down my spine, but I brushed it off as an overreaction. People move away without leaving a trace all the time, right? But as I walked back to our new home, the seed of unease had already been planted. Little did I know, that was just the beginning of a series of events that would turn our dream into a nightmare. A week had passed since we settled in, when the first threatening message arrived. It was a simple white envelope, unremarkable, but for the way my heart raced as I tore it open. Inside, a single piece of paper carried a hastily scrawled warning: "Return what you stole, or pay the price." The note was signed with a menacing flourish, but no name was attached. Initially, I thought it was a mistake or a cruel joke. After all, we were just a family trying to make a home. But seeing Michael Harrow's name at the top of the note, my stomach knotted with anxiety. Someone out there believed Michael, or someone in this apartment, had wronged them significantly. The threat was clear, and it was meant for him, not us. Yet with Michael gone and no way to contact him, the shadow of his past actions had fallen squarely on us. As days turned into weeks, the messages grew more frequent and violent. One morning, we found a rock thrown through our living room window, with a note tied around it. "Last warning." Shards of glass littered the floor like icy fragments of our shattered security. Emily's hands trembled as she swept them up, her eyes wide with fear. We started keeping the curtains drawn and double-checked the locks at night, but the sense of safety we'd once felt in our new home had eroded completely. One evening, while returning from a late shift, I felt the distinct sensation of being watched as I approached our building. The street was unusually quiet, the usual hum of city life dimmed as if holding its breath. As I fumbled for my keys at the building entrance, two figures stepped out of the shadows. "Michael, you can't hide," one of them hissed, grabbing my arm with a startling strength. Panic surged through me as I struggled, but it was their next words that froze me in place. "We know it's you, Michael. It's time to pay up." They were mistaking me for Michael Harrow. My heart pounded in my ears as I managed to break free, staggering back. "I'm not Michael," I shouted, my voice echoing down the empty street. They paused, confusion briefly crossing their faces before they advanced again. It took all my courage and a sudden, desperate sprint to escape them, ducking into a nearby cafe and calling the police. The police took statements but offered little comfort. They suggested that these people might not believe, or care, that I wasn't Michael. The realization was a gut punch. Not only were we living in Michael's shadow, we were now targets in whatever dangerous game he had left behind. Frustrated with the minimal help from the police, I decided to take matters into my own hands. The constant threat hanging over our heads was unbearable, and if the authorities wouldn't dig deeper, I would. I started by visiting the local library to access public records and newspaper archives. Hours of searching led me to a startling discovery. Michael Harrow had been a key witness in a high-profile trial against a notorious local criminal syndicate. His testimony had led to several arrests, but some members were still at large, their activities merely disrupted, not dismantled. The pieces of the puzzle began to fall into place. Michael hadn't just left a forwarding address. He had disappeared to escape retribution. And now, these criminals were after him, thinking he might still have evidence that could incriminate them further. Or worse, that I was Michael. My research uncovered more than I bargained for, dragging my family deeper into a dangerous situation. It was clear that these were not people you could simply hide from. They had resources, and they had motivation. As I sat amidst piles of old newspapers and legal documents, the weight of our predicament settled in. We were caught in the crossfire of Michael's unfinished business, and it was up to me to find a way out. One night, the illusion of safety was shattered when we returned home to find our apartment door ajar. Heart pounding, I led Emily and Lily inside with trepidation. It quickly became apparent that though our belongings were tossed about, nothing was taken. This break-in was a demonstration of our vulnerability. Our home had become the front line of a war we never wanted to fight. The following day brought an unexpected visitor. An FBI agent named Agent Thompson showed up at our doorstep. He revealed that Michael Harrow had been placed in the witness protection program after his testimony, which had led to a significant disruption of the syndicate's operations. The resemblance between Michael and me was an unfortunate coincidence that had escalated the threat against us. Agent Thompson explained that the syndicate likely believed Michael was still alive and hiding, possibly even that he had staged his disappearance to live freely under their noses. This mistaken identity placed us directly in their crosshairs. He offered FBI protection, but the thought of uprooting our lives was overwhelming. With the FBI now involved, our situation took a turn. It was no longer just about evading danger. It was about actively engaging with federal authorities to dismantle the lingering threat of a powerful enemy. Agent Thompson's presence offered a glimmer of hope, but the road ahead promised to be fraught with peril. The crisis peaked one evening as I was ambushed while taking out the trash. Swift and silent, masked figures grabbed me. A cloth doused in chemicals clamped over my face, plunging me into darkness. When I awoke, I was bound in a dimly lit, unfamiliar room, the stench of mildew in the air. My captors, rough and impatient, demanded information they believed Michael had hidden, documents that could further incriminate members of their syndicate. Desperation clawed at me, but a sliver of strategy took hold. I realized that maintaining the pretense of being Michael might buy the FBI time to locate us. "I'll talk, but you won't get anything if something happens to me," I rasped, trying to emulate what I imagined Michael's demeanor would be. My heart hammered as I played the part, each second stretching taut with danger, hoping my act would be convincing enough to keep me alive until rescue arrived. The gamble paid off. While I stalled, the FBI, using the bits of information I'd managed to provide before the kidnapping, traced my location to an abandoned warehouse on the city's outskirts. The hours I spent in captivity were agonizing, filled with a mix of fear and feigned confidence. Each minute felt like an eternity as I awaited either my end or my rescue. The rescue came with the intensity of a storm. Flashbangs erupted, disorienting my captors as FBI agents stormed the warehouse. In the chaos, I barely registered the shouts and the sounds of struggle until Agent Thompson cut through my restraints, pulling me to safety. In the aftermath, our family grappled with the echoes of terror that had invaded our lives. The apartment, once a symbol of new beginnings, now felt haunted by the events that transpired within its walls. We decided to move, seeking a fresh start away from the shadows of the past. The FBI's investigation eventually uncovered that Michael Harrow had indeed died shortly after entering witness protection. His death, obscured by secrecy to protect the investigation, had now been avenged with the dismantling of the syndicate that targeted him. As we packed to leave, I discovered a loose tile in the bathroom. Behind it was a note from Michael, his handwriting shaky. "I'm sorry to whoever finds this. I brought danger to this place. Leave before they mistake you for me." His words, a chilling reminder of our entanglement in his fate, urged us forward to our new life, away from the remnants of his. The operation led to the arrest of key syndicate leaders, significantly crippling their operations. As we drove away from the scene, the relief was palpable, but so was the realization of how close we had come to disaster. The threat was neutralized, and finally, we could breathe again, the weight of constant fear lifting slowly from our shoulders.
The day we moved into the old house on Maple Street was filled with a mixture of excitement and exhaustion. I remember looking up at the towering Victorian, its windows like eyes, and the porch welcoming us, despite a layer of dust and the passage of time. It was our new beginning, a place we could call home. As we unpacked, the house revealed its character. Creaky floorboards that sang under our feet, wallpaper that held the scent of decades, and a staircase that spiraled upwards like a question mark. It was during one of my explorations, a week after we'd settled in, that I stumbled upon the hidden room. I was in the basement, a place more for storage than living, illuminated by the dim light of a single bulb. That's when I noticed it, a peculiar outline in the wall, slightly ajar, begging for attention. Pushing against it, the false wall gave way to reveal a space that time had forgotten. A hidden room untouched, furnished with relics of a past life. A sturdy desk, a faded armchair, and shelves filled with trinkets and books. A layer of dust coated everything like a blanket preserving history. Initially, I felt like an intruder peeking into a world not meant for my eyes. Yet, there was an allure, an unspoken story lingering in the air. My family suggested we might clean it out, maybe turn it into something new. But something held me back. I couldn't shake off the feeling that the room wanted to be discovered, that it had secrets waiting to be unveiled. Though we decided to leave the room as it was for the moment, it drew me in. I found myself standing at the threshold often, peering into the darkness, listening. It felt as if the room was calling to me, whispering secrets I couldn't yet understand but was destined to uncover. A series of peculiar occurrences that I couldn't simply brush aside as quirks of an old house. It began subtly, with whispers that danced through the corridors at night, so faint I thought them figments of my imagination, stirred by the wind. But these whispers grew more distinct as if someone was murmuring secrets just beyond the edge of understanding. Objects, too, started to move inexplicably. Books I had placed on a shelf in the living room would be found on the kitchen table the next morning, and a vase of flowers shifted positions on the mantelpiece, always when our backs were turned. More unsettling was the coldness that settled in certain parts of the house, an icy grip that no amount of heating could dispel, most notably around the hidden room's entrance. Driven by a mix of fear and intrigue, my fascination with the hidden room and its mysteries turned into an obsession. I felt compelled to learn more about the house and its previous inhabitants. The local library and online archives became my sanctuaries, where I pored over old property records, newspaper clippings, and any scrap of information that could shed light on the house's history. My research led me to the troubling story of the house's former owner, a wealthy man known as much for his reclusiveness as for the rumors that swirled around his wife's sudden and unexplained disappearance. The more I learned, the more I felt an inexplicable connection to her, a woman whose voice had been silenced, whose presence seemed to linger in the very walls of our home. Delving deeper, I uncovered old letters and diaries in the local history society's archives, written by or about the people who had lived in the house. These documents hinted at a life filled with isolation and despair, particularly for the wife. It was in these moments of reading her words, feeling the echo of her loneliness, that I understood. She must have been the last occupant of the hidden room. The room, with its stale air and lingering sadness, seemed to hold the essence of her, a snapshot of her life and the desperation that must have filled her final days. This connection, formed across decades, compelled me to seek the truth not just about the hidden room, but about the woman who had become as much a part of the house as the foundations it was built upon. Her story, buried and nearly forgotten, was waiting to be told, and I felt an overwhelming responsibility to be the one to tell it. The breakthrough came unexpectedly one evening as I was drawn once more to the hidden room, a magnetism I could neither explain nor resist. As I stood in the threshold, the whispers seemed to surround me, urging me closer. Guided by an unseen force, my hand brushed against the cold, dusty wall where my fingers found the outline of a loose brick. Heart racing, I carefully removed it, revealing a hidden compartment that had been concealed within the wall for decades. Inside, wrapped in a thin layer of cloth to protect it from the ravages of time, was a small, leather-bound diary. Its pages were yellowed with age, the ink faded but still legible, bearing the intimate thoughts and fears of the missing wife. Beside the diary lay a delicate piece of jewelry, a locket, tarnished by time but unmistakably precious. I opened it to find a portrait of a woman, her eyes hauntingly familiar, filled with an unspoken sorrow. It was her, the woman whose presence permeated the house. With trembling hands, I began to read the diary, each entry drawing me deeper into her world. She wrote of her love for the house and her dreams for the future, but as the pages turned, those dreams were overshadowed by fear. She had discovered her husband's dark secrets, which she alluded to in cryptic entries, too frightened to detail them fully. Her writing grew more desperate, the tone more frantic, as she realized the danger she was in. The final entries were filled with plans to escape, to find freedom from the suffocating walls of her opulent prison. It was in these pages that I found the connection I had been seeking, a bond formed through the shared experience of uncovering hidden truths. The diary was not just a recounting of her life. It was a plea for help, a message sent across time, hoping to find someone who would listen. In the weeks that followed my discovery, a detective friend, a seasoned man with a keen eye for the overlooked, became my unexpected ally in the quest for truth. Together, we delved into the diary's cryptic messages, deciphering the hidden fears and secrets it contained. It was clear the husband harbored a darker side, his wealth and status concealing a web of criminal activities. The wife's growing awareness of his dealings had sealed her fate. Our research took us beyond the confines of the diary and the hidden room, into the heart of the husband's clandestine world. We uncovered financial records, letters, and testimonies from those who had once moved in the same circles as the couple, pieces of a puzzle that, when assembled, painted a damning picture of guilt. The evidence suggested that the wife had planned to expose her husband, a decision that led to her disappearance. Armed with our findings, we approached the authorities. The evidence was compelling, enough to convince them to reopen a case that had long been considered unsolvable. Skeptical but intrigued, they agreed to reopen the investigation, using the diary as new evidence. The diary, with its intimate recounting of fear and betrayal, became the cornerstone of the investigation. The locket, once a personal memento, served as a silent witness to the life that had been lost. The legal process was arduous, fraught with challenges as we sought justice for a crime that had occurred decades ago. As days turned into weeks, the investigation unearthed truths that had been buried for too long. The husband, though deceased, was posthumously implicated in the disappearance of his wife and presumed death, a symbolic gesture that nonetheless brought a sense of closure to a case that had haunted the community. As I stood outside the courtroom, the weight of the months-long journey pressing down on me, I realized the significance of what we had achieved. It was not just about solving a mystery or uncovering a hidden room's secrets. It was about giving voice to someone who had been silenced, about righting a wrong that had lingered in the shadows of history. I couldn't help but feel that this was a sign. The spirit of the wife, once trapped in a loop of sorrow and fear, had found peace at last. The house, once a symbol of fear and mystery, now represented something more. It was a reminder of the resilience of the human spirit, of the power of truth to transcend time and bring peace to those who had been wronged. Life in the house now feels markedly different. The air in our home felt lighter, as if a weight had been lifted from the very foundations of the house. There's a tranquility that permeates every room, a sense of closure that has mended the fabric of our family's existence here. Our evenings are no longer disturbed by unexplained occurrences. Instead, they're filled with laughter and the comforting sounds of a home at peace with its past.
I am Sarah. Originally from a small town, I moved to the city with dreams of independence and a fresh start. I've always been a blend of introverted and adventurous, enjoying my own company but also eager to explore new experiences. After looking for a long time, I finally found the perfect apartment in the city. The apartment seemed almost too perfect. It was on the ground level. It had one bedroom, one bathroom, a small living room, and a kitchen. Just what I wanted, and what I could afford to start living on my own. The place was empty at first, waiting for me to fill it with my things and make it alive. As I set up my stuff, the apartment began to feel really mine. I didn't have a problem with filling up the space with the furniture that I had, and I didn't even have that much stuff. Every box I emptied and every spot I cleaned helped me move on from the past. As the evening came, I started to relax in the way I love most. I played some of my favorite tunes, filling my new place with music. After a long day of getting things in order, I really looked forward to a hot shower. It felt amazing to wash away all the tiredness and stress. Then, I made myself a warm cup of matcha tea, my go-to drink. Holding the cup, I settled down in a cozy spot among the boxes still to be unpacked. I was all set to binge-watch my favorite series on Netflix. This was my way of celebrating my first day here, letting go of everything else. It felt like the ideal way to wrap up the day. Somebody was knocking on my front door, and glancing at the clock, I saw it was almost 10 p.m. Why would anybody be knocking on my door? I sat up and flicked on the bedroom light. It was odd for anyone to visit at this hour. I got up, walked into the living room, and turned on the light before asking, "Who's there?" a voice outside claimed to be the building's handyman. Opening the door, I was met by a man in his 40s. Although not particularly tall, his presence felt imposing, charged with an unsettling vibe. His unkempt beard and deep-set eyes, flickering with an indescribable intensity, made him all the more intimidating. Over his shoulder hung a heavy, worn-out bag, filled with tools that made a soft clanging with each of his movements. "Oh, hi there. I wasn't expecting anyone at this hour. Is everything okay?" I asked, trying to mask my unease. "Yes. All good. Just wanted to ensure your lights and Wi-Fi are working. It's important to stay connected, especially in a new place," he responded, his voice oddly comforting, yet out of place. There was something reassuring about not being entirely isolated, yet his thorough inspection of the apartment, under the guise of checking connections, reminded me starkly of my solitude. Yet, as his footsteps echoed a bit too closely, I was feeling like creeping unease. But then, something unusual happened. He said he needed to test the Wi-Fi a few more times and asked to use my computer to do it. At first, I thought nothing of it. But then he kept finding reasons to stay longer and test it again and again. It started to feel a bit odd. Him lingering around, diving into my computer under the guise of checking the connection. This twist turned my evening into a mix of appreciation and a niggling worry, making me wonder about the real reason he was insisting on using my computer so much. He finally left. As the night grew darker and quieter, I couldn't shake off a feeling of being watched. It was an eerie feeling, as if eyes were on me from somewhere unseen, watching every move I made. This wasn't the comforting familiarity of being at home. It was an invasive, prickling awareness that I wasn't truly alone. The building's natural creaks and the shifting shadows from my TV seemed charged with sinister intent, suggesting a presence always just beyond my sight. Despite this sensation, my body's need for rest overpowered my fears. The day had been long and filled with both the physical exertion of setting up my new home and the emotional strain of adapting to this unfamiliar space. I found myself drifting off to sleep. Small, almost imperceptible sound, a soft click, like a lock being turned, jolted me back to alertness. I lay there, heart pounding, straining to hear over the thud of my own heartbeat, wondering if it was just my imagination, or if something, or someone, was indeed inside my apartment. The next day when I woke up, everything seemed perfectly fine. Days went by. I was gone for most of the day at work and back at the end of the day. I saw the handyman around the building a few times, and each time he seemed to look at me in a weird way. Once he told me he really likes my paintings hanged in the apartment. I found that really odd since he'd never been in my apartment. After the strange situation, I didn't want to confront him for some reason. I didn't feel all that safe around him. I was super excited for the weekend because my sister and her boyfriend was going to visit me for the first time. Then, on Saturday, suddenly all my lights went out. I quickly called the building service, and guess what? They sent over the same handyman again. He came into my apartment and immediately shut the door behind him. He took a quick look around, almost like he wanted to make sure we were alone. Something about him just didn't feel right. Despite this, I tried to keep my distance and retreated to the kitchen, hoping to avoid any unnecessary interaction. Suddenly, I sensed someone right behind me. I could even hear them breathing. Before I had a chance to turn around, the man grabbed me, covering my mouth with his large hand, silencing my attempts to scream. He whispered threateningly that he would hurt me if I didn't stop trying to scream. Frozen with fear, I couldn't move or make any noise. The shock of the situation left me paralyzed, unable to scream or even move. Then, with a swift motion, he sealed my mouth with tape, dragging me towards my bedroom. The suddenness and intensity of his actions left me in a state of shock, my mind reeling in disbelief at the nightmarish turn of events. As an ultimate survival instinct, hoping someone might hear and help, I tried to make noise by tapping my feet on the floor. I thought maybe a neighbor or someone walking by would hear the tapping and know something was wrong. My mind raced for solutions. Just as the handyman started to drag me toward the bedroom, the unexpected happened. The doorbell rang. It kept ringing, urgently. And then I heard my sister's voice, clear and unmistakable, from the other side of the door. "We're here," she called out. Startled, he paused, his grip momentarily loosening. He suddenly jumped through the open window and disappeared. It was clear the handyman knew his way around the place too well. The doorbell was my sister and her boyfriend's doing. They had arrived earlier than planned. Their timing couldn't have been more perfect. As soon as I opened the door, she could tell something was terribly wrong. Despite being disoriented and scared, I explained to them everything that had happened. I've always cherished
We called
solitude.
The police immediately.
While waiting for them to arrive, my sister hugged me tight, living,
trying to
I
calm
my
shaking
the
body.
Quiet moments.
I was overwhelmed with relief and gratitude
for her unexpected
Late
arrival.
Nights when the streets
the police looked for the handyman
throngs.
When they arrived, but couldn't find
this
him.
Love for tranquility
it turned out
guided
he had
my
a
decision
of criminal
to
behavior
move to a new city,
that none of us in the
a
building
place
were aware
I could
of.
Start over with a clean
the police
slate.
Arrived and started
Where
looking around my apartment.
Cling to the corners of
they
buildings.
Found out something really
and
scary.
Faces in the crowd were
when
all
the handyman was here the
me.
First time to
here,
check the Wi-Fi
in this sprawling
he
metropolis
actually messed with
buzzed
my
with strangers.
Get access to my webcam.
I sought my fresh start.
This meant
I
he
relished
could watch
the anonymity,
me
without me knowing
the freedom to rebuild myself away from
all
the
those
prying
times
eyes
I felt like someone was watching
too heavy to bear. I was right. My new apartment
he turned
was a
my
modest
own computer into a
space.
Spy tool,
nestled on
this
the quieter
made me feel
side of
even
town.
More upset and betrayed.
Driving through Pittsburgh at night had become a routine for me. As a part-time rideshare driver juggling my job and night classes, the darkened streets were my workspace. One late evening, as I waited for my next ride request, the app pinged, directing me to pick up a passenger named Mark. I pulled up to the address and saw him standing there, a tall, lanky figure with a hoodie pulled tight over his head. As he slid into the back seat, I noticed how he kept glancing over his shoulder, his eyes darting around nervously. "Good evening. Where to?" I asked, trying to sound cheerful despite the uneasy vibe he exuded. "Just drive. I'll give you directions as we go," he replied, his voice strained. I nodded, starting the car and pulling away from the curb. Mark's destination turned out to be an abandoned warehouse on the outskirts of the city. I'd heard stories about that area, none of them good. But a fare was a fare, and I needed the money. The ride was eerily quiet. Mark barely spoke, his eyes glued to his phone as if waiting for something. Every few minutes his phone would buzz, and he'd have a hushed, frantic conversation that made the hairs on the back of my neck stand up. His anxiety was palpable, and it was making me uneasy. I tried to focus on the road, but my curiosity got the better of me. "Everything okay back there?" I asked, glancing at him through the rearview mirror. He looked up, his face pale. "Just keep driving," he muttered, avoiding eye contact. As we neared the warehouse, Mark suddenly leaned forward. "Take the next left, then a right. Avoid the main road." His sudden request for a detour through a less populated area only heightened my suspicion. Why was he so keen on avoiding well-lit streets? My mind raced with possibilities, each one more unsettling than the last. Was he in trouble? Was I in trouble? I took the turns as directed, the streets growing darker and more desolate with each passing block. Mark's phone buzzed again. And this time, he didn't bother to lower his voice. "I'm almost there. Just a few more minutes," he said urgently before ending the call. A few blocks from the warehouse, Mark finally asked me to stop. He fumbled with his wallet, handed me a wad of cash, and practically bolted from the car. "Thanks," he muttered, already moving away. I watched him disappear into the darkness, my curiosity turning to worry. As he walked, I noticed a shadowy figure stepping out from an alley, following him at a distance. A chill ran down my spine. Something was definitely wrong. I wanted to call out to Mark, warn him, but my voice caught in my throat. The two figures vanished into the night, leaving me alone in the deserted street. The next day, as I sipped my coffee and scrolled through the news on my phone, a headline caught my eye. "Missing person. Have you seen this man?" The photo accompanying the article made my heart skip a beat. It was Mark, the same nervous passenger I had dropped off the night before. My mind raced with questions. What had happened to him after he left my car? Who was that shadowy figure following him? And most importantly, was he still alive? I couldn't shake the feeling that I was now somehow involved in whatever trouble Mark had been running from. The fear and curiosity gnawed at me, refusing to let go. The next day,
Unable to shake off the unsettling feeling, I decided to contact the police. I provided them with all the details I could remember about Mark and our ride. Detective Harris, a gruff but attentive officer, questioned me thoroughly, jotting down every word I said. "He seemed really scared," I recounted. "Kept looking over his shoulder, taking secretive phone calls. I dropped him off near an abandoned warehouse, and there was someone following him." Detective Harris nodded but looked skeptical. "Without solid evidence, there's not much we can do right now," he admitted. "But we'll keep an eye on it." As I left the station, a gnawing sense of fear and responsibility took hold. What if I was the last person to see Mark alive? The thought was too much to bear. I knew I had to find out what happened to him, even if it meant putting myself at risk. Determined to uncover the truth, I drove back to the warehouse area, my eyes scanning every corner for clues. After hours of searching, I stumbled upon something in an alley nearby. Mark's phone, slightly battered but still functional. My hands trembled as I picked it up and managed to unlock it using the fingerprint sensor. The phone was a treasure trove of disturbing messages and calls from an unknown number. The messages were cryptic, but hinted at a dangerous situation. "You can't hide forever," one read. "We will find you," threatened another. Suddenly, my own phone buzzed with a new message from an unknown number. "Stop looking, or you'll be next." My blood ran cold. Someone was watching me, and they didn't want me digging any further. But now, I was even more determined to get to the bottom of this mystery. Piecing together the fragments from Mark's phone, I discovered that he was involved in a dangerous black market dealing with illegal goods. He had stolen something valuable from a powerful criminal organization, and they were hunting him down to get it back. One of the messages on Mark's phone stood out. "Meet me at the warehouse. We need to expose them." It seemed Mark was trying to blow the whistle on the criminal ring before he disappeared. This revelation sent chills down my spine. I was now entangled in a web of criminal activities that could easily put my life in jeopardy. Despite the growing danger, I knew I couldn't stop. Mark had been trying to do the right thing, and I felt compelled to see it through. I arranged a meeting with the person Mark was supposed to meet the night he disappeared. Using the information from Mark's phone, I set up a rendezvous at a small cafe on the outskirts of town. My heart pounded as I sat at a corner table, waiting. When a man approached, his eyes darting around nervously, I knew I had found the contact. "You must be Rachel," he whispered. "We need to talk." Before we could exchange more than a few words, the door burst open and two men stormed in. "Get her!" one of them shouted. Panic surged through me as I realized it was a trap. Using quick thinking, I threw my coffee in one man's face and bolted for the back exit. As I ran, I overheard them discussing plans to eliminate anyone investigating Mark's disappearance. It fueled my desperation to escape and get help. The criminals, now desperate to silence me, kidnapped me that night. They blindfolded me and took me to the same abandoned warehouse where Mark had vanished. My heart raced as I tried to calm my breathing, focusing on finding a way out. In the dim light, I managed to loosen my bindings using a rusty nail protruding from a wooden beam. With a burst of adrenaline, I freed myself and stealthily moved through the warehouse, avoiding the guards. Finding a phone in a deserted office, I called the authorities. Minutes felt like hours, until I heard the sound of police sirens approaching. A dramatic showdown ensued, with the police bursting in and arresting the criminals. Detective Harris himself led the charge, rescuing me from my captors. Relief washed over me as I saw the criminals being taken away in handcuffs. Rachel's bravery and determination led to the dismantling of the criminal organization. The police investigation revealed that Mark had been killed by the criminals, but his efforts were not in vain. His attempts to expose the ring helped bring them to justice. Though hailed as a hero, I was left with lingering fears and a newfound wariness of the world around me. The story ends with me driving again, more cautious, but determined to move forward. I contemplated the thin line between safety and danger, knowing how easily a routine night can turn into a nightmare. Ongoing investigations hinted at more layers to the criminal network, leaving an eerie sense of unfinished business. I glanced over at Jack,
his hand steady on the wheel as our car glided through the rolling hills of rural Pennsylvania. The sun had set hours ago, and the sky was an inky black, save for the occasional flicker of stars. We were on our way to a family reunion, hoping to reconnect with relatives we hadn't seen in years. The thought of familiar faces and shared memories made me smile. Jack had suggested taking a scenic route through Dark Hollow, a remote area renowned for its picturesque views. It seemed like a good idea at the time, a chance to enjoy some tranquility before the chaos of the reunion. However, as the miles stretched on, the road became narrower and more desolate. There were no streetlights, just the faint glow of our headlights cutting through the darkness. "Jack, are you sure this is the right way?" I asked, a hint of unease creeping into my voice. "Yeah, I'm following the GPS. We should be there in no time, Marie," he reassured me with a confident smile. Just as I began to relax, the car sputtered and lurched. Jack's smile faded as he pulled over to the side of the road. He tried to restart the engine, but it wouldn't turn over. We were stranded. Jack fiddled with the engine while I held the flashlight, its beam casting eerie shadows on the trees lining the deserted highway. Despite his efforts, it soon became clear we were out of our depth. The engine wouldn't turn over, and we didn't have the tools or expertise to diagnose the problem. "We need professional help," Jack muttered, frustration evident in his voice. As the minutes ticked by and darkness settled in, our anxiety grew. The vast emptiness around us felt increasingly oppressive, and the realization that we were utterly alone gnawed at my nerves. Just as despair began to set in, the faint rumble of an approaching vehicle broke the silence. A pair of headlights appeared in the distance, growing brighter as they neared. Jack and I exchanged a hopeful glance. The truck, an old beat-up pickup, pulled up beside us, and the driver rolled down his window. "Need some help?" The man behind the wheel was in his 50s, with a friendly smile and a reassuring demeanor. He introduced himself as Tom. Relief washed over us as we explained our predicament. "No problem at all," Tom said warmly. "I can tow you to my place. I've got tools there." Grateful for the assistance, Jack and I accepted Tom's offer. He hooked our car to his truck, and we climbed into the cab with him. The interior smelled faintly of old leather and motor oil, oddly comforting in our stressful situation. As we drove, Tom chatted amiably, asking about our trip and plans. There was something slightly off about his overly insistent hospitality, but I dismissed it as my nerves getting the better of me. Jack seemed comfortable enough, engaging in conversation and even laughing at a few of Tom's jokes. After a short drive, we arrived at Tom's farmhouse. It was isolated, surrounded by dense woods, and the only light came from a single bulb on the porch. He directed us to a large, weather-beaten barn where he promised to look at our car in the morning. "Why don't you stay the night?" Tom suggested. "I've got a guest room and it's too late to go anywhere now." Despite a nagging feeling of unease, we reluctantly agreed. Tom's demeanor remained warm, but his questions grew increasingly peculiar, making me more uncomfortable. As we settled into the guest room, I couldn't shake the sense that something was terribly wrong. "Make yourselves comfortable," Tom said, flashing that same warm smile. As he left us alone, I couldn't shake the feeling that we were being watched, and the silence of the house seemed to press in from all sides. Inside the farmhouse, Jack and I began to notice strange things that heightened our unease. The walls were adorned with old photographs, but it was the stack of outdated newspapers that caught my eye. Each one featured missing person reports, their faces staring back at me with haunting desperation. The air felt heavy, and every creak of the floorboard set my nerves on edge. As we explored further, we found several locked doors, their presence adding to the growing sense of dread. From the basement came odd, muffled noises that seemed to grow louder the longer we listened. Jack tried to rationalize it, suggesting it was just the house settling, but I wasn't so sure. Jack, ever the pragmatist, tried to dismiss my concerns. "Marie, we're exhausted. Our minds are playing tricks on us. Let's just get some sleep and figure this out in the morning." That night, I lay wide awake, every creak and groan of the old house amplifying my anxiety. Jack was asleep beside me. Suddenly, I heard soft footsteps outside our room, followed by hushed whispers. My heart raced as I quietly slipped out of bed and approached the door. Peering through the keyhole,
I saw Tom speaking with an unknown person, their conversation urgent and tense. "Something isn't right, Jack," I whispered, shaking him awake. His eyes widened as I relayed what I had seen. Our sense of dread deepened, and we knew we had to leave immediately. We tiptoed out of the guest room and made our way to the barn. But as Jack tried to start the car, it became evident that it had been tampered with. It wouldn't turn over. Panic set in as we realized we were trapped. "We need to go now," I urged, my voice trembling. Jack nodded, and we bolted from the barn, hoping to make it to the main road on foot. We had barely made it a few yards from the barn when a flashlight beam cut through the darkness, and Tom's voice called out, eerily calm. "Where do you think you're going?" We froze, and Tom approached us, his previously warm demeanor now menacing. "You're not leaving. It's not safe out there at night." Desperation flooded through me as I looked at Jack, pleading silently for a solution. My mind raced, searching for a way out of this nightmare. Back in the guest room, Tom locked the door from the outside. I heard the jingle of keys and his footsteps receding down the hall. Jack and I sat in silence, the weight of our predicament pressing down on us. The realization that we were prisoners in this isolated farmhouse was suffocating. "We have to find another way out," I whispered, my voice barely audible. Jack nodded, his face grim. I began to formulate a plan, considering every possibility. The window seemed like our best option, but we needed to wait for the right moment. As we waited for the opportune moment to escape, I began searching the guest room for anything that could help us. In the back of a dusty drawer, I found an old leather-bound journal. My hands trembled as I opened it, flipping through pages filled with meticulous handwriting. The entries detailed Tom's involvement in a series of disappearances, each more horrifying than the last. He described luring unsuspecting travelers, much like us, into his farmhouse under the guise of offering help. My blood ran cold as I read further. The journal revealed that Tom was part of a criminal gang trafficking people. The entries included names, dates, and gruesome details of how they were handed over to the gang. It was a sickening account of his twisted activities. The latest entry sent a chill down my spine. Tom planned to contact the gang the next morning to arrange our pickup. Panic and anger surged through me. We had to act fast. "Jack, look at this," I whispered urgently, showing him the journal. His face paled as he read the damning evidence. "We can't wait. We need to stop him now." Fueled by a mix of fear and determination, Jack and I devised a plan to confront Tom. We couldn't afford to wait until morning. Quietly, we crept out of the guest room, clutching the journal as our evidence. We found Tom in the kitchen, casually drinking a cup of coffee, his back turned to us. My heart pounded as I stepped forward, holding the journal tightly. "Tom, we need to talk," I said, my voice steady despite my fear. He turned, his expression shifting from surprise to cold calculation. "Found my journal, did you?" he said, his voice devoid of the warmth it once held. The facade had dropped, revealing the true predator underneath. "We're not going to let you hurt anyone else," Jack said, stepping beside me. Tom's eyes narrowed, and in an instant, he lunged at us. The kitchen erupted into chaos. Jack grappled with Tom, trying to pin him down, but Tom was surprisingly strong. Thinking quickly, I grabbed a cast iron skillet from the stove and swung it with all my might, hitting Tom squarely on the head. He crumpled to the floor, dazed, but not unconscious. "Quick, tie him up," I urged Jack, as we used whatever we could find to restrain Tom. We couldn't waste another second. Our lives depended on escaping this nightmare. We managed to drag Tom to the basement, locking the door securely behind him. Desperation fueling our actions, we found a working vehicle in a nearby shed. The old truck roared to life, and we sped through the night, the fear of pursuit driving us onward. We reached the nearest town and contacted Sheriff Davis, who quickly organized a raid on Tom's farmhouse. The raid uncovered a trove of evidence, confirming the trafficking ring's existence. Though safe, Jack and I were deeply shaken, our ordeal a chilling reminder of the lurking dangers behind seemingly friendly faces. Driving from Pittsburgh to New York City for a job interview was supposed to be an exciting adventure.
a chance to start fresh. The sun had just dipped below the horizon, casting long shadows on the highway. I'd been driving for hours, my eyes straining against the dim light. As I neared Scranton, Pennsylvania, I decided to take a break and stretch my legs. A rest stop sign gleamed ahead, promising a brief respite. I pulled into the rest stop, noting how eerily quiet it was. Only a few cars dotted the parking lot, their occupants nowhere to be seen. I parked my car and stepped out, the evening air cool against my skin. The silence felt heavy, almost oppressive, but I tried to shake off the unease creeping up my spine. As I locked my car, I noticed a man leaning against a nearby vehicle, his eyes fixed on me. He was tall and had a scruffy appearance, his gaze intense and unyielding. A shiver ran through me, but I told myself I was being paranoid. It was just a rest stop, after all. I headed toward the restroom, quickening my pace. Inside, the flickering fluorescent lights did little to ease my nerves. I splashed some water on my face, taking a moment to breathe. When I stepped out, my heart sank. The same man was there, closer now, his eyes still locked on me. "Hey there," he said, his voice low and unsettling. "Long drive?" "Yeah," I replied curtly, avoiding eye contact, "just passing through." He took a step closer, his presence overwhelming. "Where are you headed?" "New York," I muttered, taking a step back. My discomfort must have been evident because he smirked, his eyes gleaming with something that sent alarm bells ringing in my head. I decided then and there to leave. Quickly. "Have a good night," I said, forcing a polite smile before turning on my heel and walking briskly to my car. My heart pounded as I fumbled with the keys, finally getting the door open. I glanced back to see him still watching me, his expression unreadable. As I sped out of the parking lot, my unease turned into a gnawing fear. I couldn't shake the feeling that something was terribly wrong. Back on the highway, the adrenaline from my encounter with the creepy man began to fade, replaced by a growing sense of dread. Glancing in my rearview mirror, my heart skipped a beat. There he was, his car a dark silhouette against the fading light, following me at a distance. I tried to tell myself it was just a coincidence, but the nagging fear wouldn't go away. I pressed my foot on the accelerator, speeding up in hopes of losing him. But as I weaved through traffic and took random exits, he remained on my tail, never losing sight of me. My hands gripped the steering wheel, knuckles white with tension. My mind raced with possibilities, each more terrifying than the last. Why was he following me? What did he want? Panic set in, my breaths coming in shallow gasps as I realized he wasn't giving up. No matter how fast I drove or how many turns I took, he stayed right behind me, like a predator stalking its prey. Desperation clawed at me as I spotted a gas station up ahead. I swerved into the parking lot, my tires screeching against the pavement. Without wasting a second, I jumped out of the car and ran inside, the bell above the door jingling loudly. The clerk, a middle-aged man with kind eyes, looked up from his magazine, startled. "Can I help you?" he asked. "Please, you have to help me," I panted, my voice shaking. "There's a man following me. I think he means to harm me." Concern flashed across his face, and he immediately reached for the phone. "I'll call the police. Just stay here." I nodded, my eyes darting around the store as I tried to calm my racing heart. The minutes felt like hours as I waited, each second dragging on in agonizing silence. The clerk spoke softly into the phone, glancing at me with reassuring nods. Finally, the faint sound of sirens pierced the stillness of the night. Relief washed over me, but it was tempered by the persistent fear that the man was still out there, watching and waiting. I hugged my arms to myself, trying to shake the feeling of being hunted, knowing the police would soon arrive to put an end to this nightmare. The police arrived within minutes, their flashing lights casting an eerie glow over the gas station. I ran out to meet them, pointing wildly in the direction where I last saw the car. But to my utter disbelief, there was no sign of him or his vehicle. It was as if he had vanished into thin air. Officer Davis, a tall, no-nonsense cop with a stern expression, took my statement. I recounted everything: the rest stop, the man's unsettling behavior, the relentless chase, and my desperate flight to the gas station. We'll keep an eye out for him, Officer Davis assured me, his voice calm but authoritative. In the meantime, try to stay calm and continue your journey. We'll patrol the area and see if we can find him. Despite his words, a lingering sense of dread clung to me as I got back into my car. The police presence provided little comfort. The image of the man's intense gaze was burned into my mind, and I couldn't shake the feeling that this wasn't over. With a heavy heart, I continued my drive, eyes constantly flicking to the rearview mirror. Exhaustion hit me hard by the time I reached a small motel for the night. My nerves were frayed, and my body ached from the tension. I checked in, barely noticing the friendly smile of the receptionist, and dragged myself to my room, craving the escape of sleep. Just as I was about to drift off, my phone rang, startling me. It was Officer Davis. "We found the car. His name is Mike, and he is known by our services," he said. "It was abandoned not far from the gas station. We're looking into it, but I wanted to let you know we're taking this seriously." Relief washed over me momentarily, but it was quickly replaced by a cold, creeping fear. I thanked him and hung up, trying to take solace in the fact that the police were on the case. As I prepared for bed, I noticed a slip of paper under the door. My heart pounded as I picked it up, dread pooling in my stomach. The note was brief but chilling. "I know where you are." Panic surged through me. Mike had somehow tracked me to this motel. I felt trapped, every shadow in the room seeming to loom larger, every creak of the building magnified in my ears. The nightmare was far from over, and I knew I couldn't let my guard down for a second. My hands trembled as I dialed the police again, my voice barely steady as I explained the situation. "He's here. Mike is here. And he knows where I am," I whispered, trying to keep my panic in check. The dispatcher assured me that officers were on their way, but it felt like a lifetime. I pushed the dresser against the door, creating a makeshift barricade, and clutched my phone, listening intently for any sound. My heart raced as footsteps echoed down the hallway. Suddenly, a loud crash against the door made me jump. The wood splintered as Mike forced his way in, his eyes wild with rage. "Thought you could get away, didn't you?" he snarled, advancing toward me. Desperation took over, and I grabbed the nearest thing I could find, a heavy lamp. As he lunged, I swung it with all my might, the impact sending him staggering back, clutching his head. The momentary advantage was all I needed. I bolted past him, adrenaline propelling me forward. I raced down the hallway, my pulse pounding in my ears, and burst into the motel lobby, shouting for help. The police arrived just in time, their sirens a welcome sound. Mike, disoriented and bleeding, stumbled out of the room, only to be tackled by Officer Davis and his team. They handcuffed him, his menacing presence finally subdued. "Are you all right?" Officer Davis asked, guiding me to a chair. I nodded, too shaken to speak. He explained that Mike was a wanted criminal with a long history of stalking and violence. "We've been after him for months. You did the right thing by contacting us," he said, his tone reassuring. Though my body trembled with residual fear, I felt a strange sense of relief knowing that Mike was no longer a threat. The ordeal had been harrowing, but my actions had helped capture a dangerous man. I knew I had narrowly escaped a far worse fate. Working out at the gym in Boston had become my daily routine, a place where I could focus on my fitness goals and escape the stresses of my busy life. My friend Jess often joined me for our evening sessions. Her company made the workouts enjoyable and motivating. We had our routine down to a science: cardio first, then strength training, and a cool down with stretching. One evening, as I was lifting weights, I noticed a new member. He was tall with dark hair and an intense gaze that seemed to follow me everywhere. At first I brushed it off, thinking it was just my imagination. After all, it was a public gym, and people watched others all the time. But as the days passed, I couldn't shake the feeling of being watched. His eyes were always on me, no matter where I was in the gym. His presence made me uneasy, but I tried to ignore it, telling myself I was being paranoid. Over the next few weeks, the man, who I learned was named Luke, began showing up at the gym every time I was there. He always seemed to be on the adjacent equipment, mirroring my workout routine. It was as if he had memorized my schedule. He would smile and nod, attempting to engage me in small talk. "Hey, I've seen you around. What's your name?" he asked one evening, his tone overly friendly. I forced a polite smile, keeping my answer short. "Ava, nice to meet you. Just noticed Luke's behavior too." "That guy gives me the creeps," she said one night as we left the gym. "You should be careful." I decided to change my workout times, hoping to avoid Luke, but it didn't take long for him to adjust his schedule to match mine. No matter when I went, he was always there. My anxiety grew with each encounter. It was clear that his interest in me was more than just casual. The once comforting atmosphere of the gym now felt threatening. I began to dread my workouts, constantly looking over my shoulder, feeling his eyes on me. Jess's words echoed in my mind, and I knew I had to be more vigilant. Luke's behavior escalated quickly. What started as casual conversation turned into him following me around the gym. He would linger near the machines I used, and I even caught him waiting for me outside the gym. His presence felt more suffocating each day. One evening, I found a small gift on the hood of my car, a bouquet of flowers with a note that read, "For my favorite gym buddy." The gesture might have been sweet under different circumstances, but coming from Luke, it sent a chill down my spine. The next day, it was a handwritten poem about watching from afar. Each gift and note became more personal, more unsettling. I reported his behavior to the gym management. They listened sympathetically and promised to keep an eye on him, but their reassurances felt hollow. Luke wasn't violating any gym rules, and they couldn't ban him based on my discomfort alone. Despite their promises, nothing changed. Luke continued his relentless pursuit, and my safe haven became a place of dread. The gym management's lack of action left me feeling vulnerable and exposed. My fear grew with each passing day. The notes and gifts became more frequent, and his behavior more invasive. I decided it was time to involve the police. I went to the local precinct and spoke with Officer Martinez, a kind but serious officer who took my statement. "I need you to document every interaction," he advised. "Keep a record of his messages and any encounters. It will help us build a case." Despite involving the police, Luke's stalking intensified. He somehow hacked into my social media accounts, sending me threatening messages from my own profiles. It felt like he was everywhere, monitoring my every move. The sense of violation was overwhelming. Taking Officer Martinez's advice to heart, I installed security cameras around my home and changed the locks on my doors. Every creak and shadow made me jump. I felt trapped, constantly looking over my shoulder, wondering when Luke might strike next. The walls of my once safe world were closing in, and I knew I had to find a way to reclaim my life from this nightmare. One evening, as I was scrolling through my messages, a notification popped up from a member of the gym's online community. She had seen Luke's picture and warned me that he wasn't who he claimed to be. After some quick research, I discovered that Luke was using a fake name. His real name was David, and he had a history of stalking and violence against women. My blood ran cold as I read the articles detailing his past crimes. That same evening at the gym, David confronted me in the locker room. He cornered me against the cold tiles, his face twisted in anger. "I know about your little police report," he hissed. "You need to drop it. You have no idea what I'm capable of." My heart pounded in my chest. Just when I thought it couldn't get any worse, Jess walked in. She immediately sensed the danger and shouted, "Get away from her!" The distraction gave me the chance to push past him and run. Together, Jess and I fled the gym, our breaths ragged with fear. We called the police as soon as we reached my car. Officer Martinez reassured us that they would catch David, but the fear that he would come after us lingered. The police arrived at the gym within minutes, but David had already vanished. Officer Martinez initiated a citywide search, but I couldn't shake the feeling that he was always one step ahead. Jess insisted I stay at her apartment for safety, and I gratefully accepted. Days passed, and I started to feel a semblance of security. Then, late one night, we heard a window shatter. David had found us. He broke into the apartment, his eyes wild and menacing. The fear was paralyzing, but I knew we had to act fast. In the chaos, I grabbed a kitchen knife. the only weapon within reach. As David lunged at us, I swung the knife, catching him off guard and injuring him. He stumbled back, giving Jess and me just enough time to escape the apartment and call for help. The police arrived swiftly, and this time, they managed to apprehend David as he tried to flee. He was finally taken into custody, his reign of terror brought to an end. The relief was overwhelming, but the ordeal had left its mark on both Jess and me. We had faced a real-life nightmare and survived, but the scars would take time to heal. As the police surrounded the apartment building, David attempted to flee, but he was quickly apprehended. Handcuffs secured, he was arrested and charged with multiple counts of stalking, harassment, and attempted assault. Seeing him taken away was a moment of immense relief for both Jess and me. Officer Martinez approached us with a reassuring smile. "He's not going to hurt anyone else," he said firmly. "With the evidence we've gathered, David will face significant jail time." His words brought a measure of peace to my frazzled nerves. The legal process began swiftly, and David's history of violence and stalking worked against him in court. Knowing that he would be off the streets for a long time helped me start to reclaim a sense of normalcy. It wasn't just about my safety anymore. It was about ensuring he couldn't harm anyone else. Jess and I leaned on each other for support, our bond stronger than ever. The experience had been harrowing, but it also highlighted the importance of friendship and vigilance. As I resumed my fitness journey, I took extra precautions. I switched gyms, varied my workout routines, and stayed alert to my surroundings. The experience left me with lingering fears, but it also instilled in me a sense of empowerment and resilience. Running along the Charles River, I felt a renewed sense of freedom. The trauma of the past months had not broken me. It had made me stronger. I was determined not to let fear control my life. Instead, I embraced each day with vigilance and strength, knowing I had faced and overcome a terrifying ordeal. Arriving in Boston for my work conference felt exhilarating. I had found a chic downtown apartment on Airbnb, and the photos had promised a stylish, comfortable stay. When I pulled up to the address, I was pleased to find it looked even better in person. Eric, the host, was waiting outside, smiling warmly as he greeted me. "Welcome to Boston, Mia. I hope you'll love the apartment," he said, opening the door and helping me with my luggage. Eric gave me a thorough tour, pointing out the modern amenities: a sleek kitchen with stainless steel appliances, a cozy living room with a big screen TV, and a spacious bedroom with an ensuite bathroom. "The location is perfect," he continued. "You're within walking distance of great restaurants, shops, and the conference center." As he left, I thanked him, feeling impressed by the place, but also experiencing a slight unease I couldn't quite place. I shook it off, attributing it to travel fatigue and the unfamiliar environment. The first couple of days in Boston were great. I attended my conference, explored the city, and enjoyed the comfort of the apartment. But soon, I started noticing oddities. Items seemed to move on their own. My phone charger wasn't where I left it, and my laptop began acting strangely, turning on and off by itself. At night, I heard strange noises, soft creaks and faint whispers that made my skin crawl. I couldn't shake the feeling that I was being watched. I tried to convince myself it was just an old building settling, but the unease grew stronger. Then, one evening, I received a message from an unknown number. When I opened it, my heart sank. It was a video clip of me in the apartment, taken without my knowledge. The accompanying message demanded money in exchange for not releasing the footage online. Panic set in as I realized the extent of the invasion. Someone had been spying on me, and they had access to every private moment I thought I had. The chic, stylish apartment now felt like a trap, and the unease I had brushed off earlier returned with full force. I knew I had to act quickly and carefully to uncover the truth behind this violation. My hands were trembling as I reread the threatening message. I couldn't ignore the creeping suspicion any longer. I started a thorough search of the apartment, my heart pounding in my chest. It didn't take long to find the hidden cameras. They were skillfully placed, almost invisible to the casual observer. There was one in the bedroom, cleverly disguised within a digital clock, and another in the bathroom, concealed behind a vent. My mind raced as I pieced everything together. Eric's overly friendly demeanor suddenly took on a sinister undertone. He had access to the apartment and seemed to know too much about my schedule and habits. It had to be him. Determined to gather evidence, I took photos and videos of the cameras and their locations. I documented everything meticulously, including the interactions I had with Eric. I needed solid proof to ensure that he couldn't wriggle out of this. The next morning, I went to the local police station and met Detective Riley. She was calm and professional, listening intently as I poured out my story. "I found hidden cameras in the apartment," I explained, showing her the evidence I had gathered. Detective Riley nodded, taking notes. "This is serious, Mia. We'll investigate, but we need more evidence to act directly against Eric. Can you stay in the apartment for another night and keep a low profile? We'll monitor the situation closely." The thought of staying another night made my skin crawl, but I knew it was necessary. "All right, I'll do it," I agreed, my voice steady despite the fear gnawing at me. That night, as I was trying to stay calm and alert, I found a small drawer in the living room that I hadn't noticed before. Inside was a crumpled piece of paper with a name and number. Clara. A chill ran down my spine. Was she another victim? I immediately called her. "Clara, this is Mia. I'm staying in an Airbnb hosted by Eric. Did he—" "Yes," Clara interrupted, her voice trembling. "He did the same thing to me. I've been too scared to come forward. Please, we need to stop him." Clara's words gave me the strength to push forward. With Detective Riley's help and Clara's testimony, I felt a glimmer of hope that we could end Eric's predatory game. After my chilling conversation with Clara, the gravity of the situation became even clearer. She confirmed my worst fears. Eric had been blackmailing her with incriminating footage for months, and she had been paying him to keep it quiet. Clara's voice trembled as she recounted her ordeal, but despite her fear, she agreed to help me and the police catch Eric. With Clara on board, we devised a plan with Detective Riley, but Eric must have sensed something was amiss. That evening, as I was nervously preparing to meet Detective Riley for a final briefing, there was a knock on the door. I opened it to find Eric standing there, his friendly mask replaced with a menacing glare. "I know what you're doing, Mia," he hissed, stepping into the apartment. "You think you can get away with reporting me to the police? Think again." My heart pounded as I tried to stay calm. "Eric, I don't know what you're talking about." "Don't play dumb," he snapped, grabbing my arm. "I have friends in high places. Drop this, or you'll regret it." Fear threatened to paralyze me, but I managed to nod, hoping he would leave. Eric finally released me and stormed out, leaving me shaken, but more determined than ever. Detective Riley and her team quickly set up a sting operation. Mia and Clara's help was crucial to catching Eric in the act. The plan was simple. Eric would think he was meeting me alone to extort more money, but the police would be ready to intervene. The next evening, with a wire hidden under my clothes and my heart racing, I waited in the apartment for Eric. Right on cue, he showed up, his face twisted with arrogance and malice. "You've made a big mistake, Mia," he said, stepping inside. I played along, pretending to be scared and compliant. "Please, Eric, I'll do whatever you want. Just don't release the footage." As Eric began his usual threats and demands, Detective Riley and her team burst in. "Boston PD, Eric, you're under arrest." Caught off guard, Eric tried to flee, shoving past the officers and bolting down the hallway. The building erupted into chaos. I ran after them, adrenaline fueling my every step. Eric's desperation led him to the rooftop, where he thought he could escape. But I wasn't about to let him get away. As Eric reached the edge, I grabbed a loose pipe and swung it towards him. He stumbled, buying just enough time for Detective Riley and her team to tackle him to the ground. Handcuffs secured around his wrists, Eric's reign of terror was finally over. The police confiscated the hidden footage and took him away, ensuring he couldn't harm anyone else. The ordeal had been terrifying, but with Clara's bravery and Detective Riley's support, we had put an end to Eric's predatory game. Eric was swiftly charged with multiple counts of blackmail, invasion of privacy, and harassment. The extent of his crimes, spanning numerous victims, meant that the evidence against him was overwhelming. Detective Riley assured Clara and me that Eric would face significant jail time and that every piece of incriminating footage would be destroyed. "Thank you for your bravery," Detective Riley said, offering a reassuring smile. "You've helped put a dangerous man behind bars." The relief was palpable, yet a lingering fear remained. The invasion of privacy had left a deep scar, and the thought of someone violating my personal space so profoundly would take time to heal. Clara and I exchanged grateful glances, our shared experience forging a bond of resilience and support. Despite the lingering uneasy, I felt immense gratitude for the unwavering support from Clara and the diligent efforts of Detective Riley and her team. Knowing that Eric could no longer harm anyone else provided a measure of comfort. As the work conference continued, I approached each day with heightened awareness and precaution. My experience had taught me the importance of vigilance and the power of community in overcoming adversity. Every summer, my family and I escape to our summer house in Rockport, Massachusetts. It's a quaint coastal town where everyone knows everyone, and life moves a little slower. This year was no different. I picked up my usual summer job at the local grocery store owned by the Millers, a sweet old couple who treated me like their own grandchild. One evening, while I was stacking shelves, I noticed a drifter hanging around the store. He looked out of place with his scruffy clothes and unkempt beard. His eyes darted around, watching the employees and customers with a creepy intensity. I felt a shiver run down my spine. Something about him made me uneasy, but I brushed it off. Small towns always had their share of oddballs, right? "Can I help you with something?" I asked, trying to sound polite. He didn't respond, just kept staring. I forced a smile and returned to my work, hoping he'd leave soon. After a while, he wandered out of the store, but the uneasy feeling lingered. Over the next few days, I started seeing the drifter, who I learned was named Tom, more frequently. He'd hang around the store, lurking in the parking lot or just standing nearby, watching. His behavior was becoming more unsettling. He'd make creepy comments to me and the other employees, things that sent chills down my spine. "Nice day, isn't it? You look like you've got a lot on your mind," he'd say, his tone dripping with something I couldn't quite place. One evening, my sister Kate came home looking shaken. "I saw that guy from your work, the creepy one. He was lurking near our house," she told us, her voice trembling. My parents were immediately concerned. We reported it to the local authorities, but they were slow to take action. "He's probably harmless, just a drifter passing through," the sheriff said, trying to reassure us. But Tom's presence didn't feel harmless. It felt invasive, like he was watching and waiting for something. My family grew more anxious with each passing day. The once peaceful summer house now felt like a place of dread, and we couldn't shake the feeling that we were being hunted. One evening, as the sun dipped below the horizon, I decided to take out the trash. As I approached the garage, I heard a faint rustling sound. I froze, straining to listen. Suddenly, I saw Tom trying to jimmy open the garage door with a crowbar. My heart raced. "Hey, what do you think you're doing?" I shouted, adrenaline surging through my veins. Tom looked up, his eyes wild with anger, then bolted into the woods behind our house. I stood there, breathless and shaken, before running back inside to tell my family. We immediately called Sheriff Lawson, who arrived shortly after. He took our statement, his brow furrowed with concern. "I'll keep an eye on the situation," he promised, "but our resources are limited. We'll do our best." The next morning, we found a note on our porch. The handwriting was messy and aggressive. "Stay out of my business, or else." The threat was clear, and fear settled over our home like a dark cloud. Tom's behavior became more aggressive with each passing day. One morning, we woke up to find our summer house vandalized. Windows were smashed, and the walls were defaced with disturbing graffiti. My dad's car tires were slashed, leaving us feeling trapped and vulnerable. We felt helpless as Tom's actions grew bolder and more violent. The sense of safety we once felt in our summer home was replaced with constant anxiety. Sheriff Lawson visited us again, advising us to install security cameras and to stay indoors after dark. "We need to document everything," he said. "It'll help us build a case against him." We followed his advice,
setting up cameras around the house and sticking together inside after sunset. But the fear was inescapable. Every creak of the house, every shadow, made us jump. Tom's presence loomed over us, a constant reminder that our safety was under threat. As the days went by, the tension in our home grew unbearable. We knew we had to find a way to end this nightmare, but we didn't know how. Tom's relentless harassment had pushed us to our breaking point, and we were desperate for a solution. Kate and I couldn't take it anymore. We needed answers. We spent hours on the internet, digging into public records and local news archives. What we found sent shivers down our spines. Tom had a long criminal record, including assault and burglary. It was clear he was dangerous. Our search led us to an abandoned shack on the outskirts of Rockport. The place was dilapidated, hidden away among the trees. We crept closer, peeking inside through a broken window. The sight was chilling. The shack was filled with stolen items and crude maps of our neighborhood. It was a makeshift lair, and it confirmed our worst fears. Tom had been stalking multiple families, not just ours. We hurried to relay our findings to Sheriff Lawson. He organized a search of the shack, but when his team arrived, it was empty. However, they found enough evidence to suggest Tom had been living there and tracking his victims meticulously. The sheriff's concern was palpable. "We're dealing with someone very dangerous," he said. "We'll increase patrols, but you need to stay vigilant." That night, I lay in bed, unable to sleep, haunted by the images of Tom's lair. Sometime after midnight, I heard a faint noise coming from downstairs. My heart pounded as I got up to investigate. As I descended the stairs, I saw Tom inside our house, rifling through our belongings. The sight of him in our living room ignited a surge of adrenaline. "Get out!" I shouted, charging at him. A violent struggle ensued. Tom was strong and desperate, but I fought back with everything I had. In the chaos, I managed to knock him off balance. As we grappled, he dropped something, a burner phone. I snatched it up, hoping it held some answers. "Who are you working for?" I demanded. But Tom just snarled and broke free, escaping through the back door. Shaken and bruised, I clutched the phone and called Sheriff Lawson. When he arrived, I showed him the device. Together, we went through the messages. They revealed a series of incriminating texts from an unknown individual who seemed to have a vendetta against my family. The texts detailed our movements, providing instructions to Tom on how to terrorize us. "This isn't just about Tom," I said, my voice trembling. "Someone else is behind this, someone who wants to destroy us." Sheriff Lawson nodded grimly. "We'll trace this phone and find out who's orchestrating this. But for now, you need to stay somewhere safe." The discovery of the burner phone changed everything. It wasn't just Tom. We were dealing with a far more sinister plot than we had imagined. The realization was terrifying, but it also fueled our determination to uncover the truth and put an end to this nightmare. We decided it was no longer safe to stay in Rockport. The morning light barely pierced the heavy fog as we hurriedly packed our belongings. The plan was to leave before Tom could strike again. However, just as we were loading the last bags into the car, he appeared, a wild look in his eyes. "You think you can run?" Tom snarled, brandishing a knife. My family froze, fear etched on their faces. Before I could react, Sheriff Lawson and his deputies arrived, guns drawn. They had traced the burner phone to a location near our house and had been monitoring it closely. "Drop the knife, Tom," Sheriff Lawson commanded. A tense standoff ensued. Tom, realizing he was cornered, lunged towards my father. Acting on pure instinct, I grabbed a shovel from the garden and swung it, striking Tom's arm and causing him to drop the knife. Sheriff Lawson and his deputies seized the opportunity, tackling Tom to the ground and handcuffing him. "Are you all right?" the sheriff asked, helping me up. I nodded, shaking with adrenaline but relieved it was finally over. Tom was subdued, and we were safe for now. With Tom in custody, the investigation quickly unraveled the mystery behind the vendetta. The unknown individual behind the scheme turned out to be a former business rival of my father's. Years ago, a business deal had gone sour, and the rival had harbored a deep-seated grudge. He had hired Tom to terrorize us as an act of revenge. The authorities assured us that both Tom and the mastermind would face serious charges. The relief was immense,
but the psychological scars remained. The once idyllic summer house now felt tainted by the horrors we had endured. Despite the resolution, we decided to sell the summer house. It no longer felt like a safe haven. Instead, it was a constant reminder of the nightmare we had lived through. We needed a fresh start, a place where we could rebuild our sense of security and peace. As we drove away from Rockport for the last time, I looked back at the house, feeling a mixture of sorrow and relief. The past months had tested us in ways we never imagined, but we had come out stronger, united by our determination to protect each other. Moving forward, we carried the lessons of vigilance and resilience, ready to create new, safer memories together. Living alone in Greenfield, Massachusetts, was a peaceful existence. As a retired detective, I cherished the quiet life, tending to my garden and diving into crime novels. My daughter, Sarah, visited often, bringing life and laughter into the old house. One evening, while Sarah was away on a business trip, the power suddenly went out. The house was plunged into darkness, and my instincts kicked in. Grabbing a flashlight, I headed to the basement to check the circuit breaker. As I was inspecting the breaker, a sudden noise reached my ears, the unmistakable sound of glass breaking from upstairs. My heart pounded as I realized someone was breaking into my home. Panic surged through me as I quickly hid in the basement and dialed 911. The darkness felt oppressive, and every sound was amplified. I listened intently as the intruder moved through the house, their flashlight casting flickering beams of light through the cracks in the floorboards above. Officer Daniels arrived swiftly, but the intruder had already fled by the time he got there. We discovered that the power line to the house had been cut cleanly, indicating a premeditated attack. The police found a few footprints outside and a discarded cigarette butt, but it wasn't much to go on. My heart raced as the realization sank in. This was no random break-in. My mind wandered back to a case from 10 years ago. A violent criminal named Mike, who I had arrested, had vowed revenge as he was led away in handcuffs. The memory sent a chill down my spine. Could it really be him? The timing seemed too perfect to be a coincidence. I shared my suspicions with Officer Daniels, explaining the details of Mike's arrest and his threats. Daniels listened intently, nodding as he took notes. "I'll look into Mike's current whereabouts," he promised. Despite his reassurance, I couldn't shake the feeling of impending danger. I knew I had to dig deeper into Mike's past and current activities if I wanted to protect myself and my daughter. Determined to find answers, I spent the next few days digging through my old case files. Mike had associates and habits that I meticulously documented years ago. I noticed a pattern of behavior that suggested he might be hiding in an old warehouse on the outskirts of town, a place he had used as a hideout before. Armed with this information, I decided to visit the warehouse. It was a dilapidated building, long abandoned and covered in graffiti. My flashlight cut through the dim interior, revealing signs of recent activity. There were food wrappers scattered around, a makeshift bed in the corner, and, most disturbingly, a map of my neighborhood with my house circled in red. I took photos of everything and brought them to Officer Daniels. He confirmed that Mike had been released from prison recently and was likely the one behind the break-in. This discovery added a new layer of urgency to the situation. Mike wasn't just planning revenge, he was actively stalking me. The evidence pointed to a calculated and dangerous individual, and I knew we had to act fast to stop him before he struck again. That night, I received a phone call that sent a shiver down my spine. Mike's voice crackled through the line, dripping with malice. "Miss me, old man? I've been watching you. Don't get too comfortable. I'll be seeing you real soon." The threat was clear, and my suspicions were confirmed. I wasted no time preparing for a potential confrontation. I set up security cameras around the house and secured all entry points. I even rigged a few makeshift alarms using old detective tricks. I was determined to be ready. Despite my precautions, Mike managed to break in again. The sound of shattering glass jolted me from my chair, and I confronted him in the living room. The struggle was fierce, each of us fighting for control. I used my knowledge of the house to my advantage, maneuvering through the familiar terrain. Just as I thought I had the upper hand, Mike delivered a blow that sent me sprawling. I scrambled to my feet, ready to face whatever came next. During the struggle, I made a startling discovery. Mike wasn't working alone. Another figure emerged from the shadows, someone I recognized from another case years ago. He was an accomplice from a past arrest, someone who held a grudge just as deeply as Mike did. The realization hit me like a ton of bricks. As we fought, Sarah returned home unexpectedly. She walked into the chaos, eyes wide with shock. "Dad!" she screamed, rushing to call Officer Daniels. The sight of my daughter fueled my determination. I couldn't let anything happen to her. With a burst of strength, I overpowered Mike, pinning him to the ground. But his partner, seeing the tide turn, managed to escape. In his haste, he left behind a cryptic note that chilled me to the bone. "This isn't over." Officer Daniels arrived moments later, securing Mike and checking on Sarah and me. The threat wasn't entirely gone, but we had won this battle. As Mike was taken away, I couldn't shake the feeling of unfinished business. His partner was still out there, and I knew this fight was far from over. With Sarah safe, Officer Daniels and I devised a plan to lure Mike's partner out. We used the cryptic note as a clue and set a trap at an old abandoned factory where I had once apprehended him. It was the perfect place to end this. The anticipation was nerve-wracking, but I knew it was the only way to ensure our safety. The partner took the bait, arriving at the factory under the cover of night. The final confrontation was intense. As he crept through the shadows, I stepped out, flashlight in hand. "It's over," I declared, my voice steady despite the adrenaline coursing through me. He lunged at me, but I was ready. Officer Daniels emerged from his hiding spot, and together we fought to subdue him. The struggle was brief but fierce. We managed to overpower him, securing him in handcuffs. The sense of relief was overwhelming. Both he and Mike were finally in custody, charged with multiple crimes that would ensure they'd be off the streets for a long time. Sarah and I were shaken but relieved. We fortified the house with additional security measures and leaned on the support of our close-knit community. Officer Daniels commended my bravery, reassuring us that both criminals would face significant jail time. Despite the harrowing experience, I felt a deep sense of closure. Helping put two dangerous men behind bars was a reminder of my purpose, even in retirement. Life slowly returned to normal. I resumed my quiet routine, more vigilant but determined not to live in fear. Sarah visited more often, and we cherished our time together, grateful for the bond that had grown even stronger through adversity. Mark and I had just moved into our dream home in Worcester, Massachusetts. The suburban neighborhood seemed perfect for starting our new life together. The tree-lined streets, friendly neighbors, and quiet evenings were everything we had hoped for. A few weeks after settling in, Mark saw someone running from our house one evening. The next day, we found a dead patch of grass under our window and started hearing strange clicking sounds at night. At first, we brushed it off as our imagination or thought it might be harmless neighborhood kids playing pranks. But as the incidents continued, they became too disturbing to ignore. The clicking sounds grew louder and more frequent, making it hard to sleep. Mark and I were constantly on edge, jumping at every noise. Our once peaceful home had turned into a source of anxiety and fear. One night, after another bout of restless tossing and turning, we decided to thoroughly inspect the house. To our horror, we discovered small, hidden cameras disguised as ordinary objects. The realization that someone was watching us was horrifying. Our sanctuary had been violated. We immediately called the police. Detective Thompson came to investigate and found that the power lines had been tampered with, likely to disable our security system. Knowing that someone had gone to such lengths to infiltrate our home filled us with dread. The fear of not knowing who was behind it all consumed us. Detective Thompson found traces of a white powder near the dead patch of grass and took samples for analysis. It was a small but potentially significant lead. Meanwhile, Mark and I started asking our neighbors if they had seen anything suspicious. Most were friendly but clueless, offering little more than sympathy. One elderly neighbor, Mrs. Henderson, mentioned seeing a suspicious van parked nearby several times. Her recollection was clear and detailed, which gave us a solid lead. Using this information,
Detective Thompson checked local surveillance footage but didn't find anything conclusive. The van's appearances were sporadic and didn't provide enough evidence to identify who was behind it. Determined to find answers, Mark and I decided to do some investigating ourselves. We started keeping a close watch on our neighborhood, noting any unusual activity. Every evening we took turns watching from the living room window, hoping to catch a glimpse of something out of the ordinary. One night, our vigilance paid off. We saw the suspicious van Mrs. Henderson had mentioned. We discreetly followed it, as it made several stops at different houses, with people quickly exchanging packages at each location. The realization hit us hard. Our home was being used as a drop-off point for a drug operation. The dead patch of grass marked the spot for pickups, and the clicking sounds were signals for the exchanges. The pieces of the puzzle were falling into place, but the danger was far from over. We knew we had to act fast to stop this before it escalated further. We reported our findings to Detective Thompson, who set up a sting operation to catch the culprits. He advised us to stay away from the house for a few days, but we insisted on staying to help. The operation was tense, and the atmosphere was thick with anxiety. We watched from a safe distance as the police monitored our house. Late one night, the van returned, and a man approached the marked spot. As the police moved in, a shootout ensued. Mark and I were terrified, hearts pounding as gunshots echoed through the night. Thankfully, the police apprehended the suspects, bringing a wave of relief over us. The immediate threat seemed to be over, but I couldn't shake the feeling that there was more to uncover. While we were celebrating the successful operation, Detective Thompson received a call that changed everything. The powder analysis revealed that it wasn't drugs, but a chemical used in explosives. The revelation sent a new wave of fear through me. The suspects in custody weren't just drug dealers. They were part of a larger criminal network involved in arms trafficking. Our house was not just a drop-off point, but a storage location for dangerous materials. The discovery of explosives hidden in our basement, undetected during the initial investigation, made our situation even more perilous. The danger we had narrowly avoided was far greater than we had imagined. Knowing that our home had been used in such a dangerous operation made us question everything. We were grateful for the police's swift action, but the sense of violation and fear lingered long after the immediate threat was gone. Detective Thompson intensified the investigation, discovering that the criminal network was planning a major operation, and our house was central to their plans. We were placed under protective custody, but I couldn't shake the feeling of impending danger. I insisted on helping the police from a remote location, determined to see this through. The police used our house to set a final trap. The criminals, unaware of the heightened security, attempted to retrieve their materials. A dramatic showdown unfolded. As the criminals entered our property, the police were ready. The tension was palpable as a fierce firefight broke out. The police narrowly prevented a catastrophic event by apprehending the criminals just in time. The entire operation was dismantled, and the threat was finally neutralized. Mark and I were shaken, but immensely grateful for the swift action of the police. We fortified our home with advanced security measures and leaned on each other for support during the difficult days that followed. Detective Thompson commended our bravery and assured us that the criminals would face significant jail time. Despite the harrowing experience, we felt a sense of closure. Knowing that we had helped stop a dangerous network brought us some peace. The fear and anxiety began to fade as we adjusted to our new reality, more cautious but no longer living in constant dread.